Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Anatomy of the Nuremberg Trials, a personal memoir by Telford Taylor, narrated by James Patrick Cronin. Introduction. In the spring of 1945, I was a reserve colonel in the intelligence branch of the United States Army. My duties had to do with information derived from the deciphering of enemy messages, the product of which in recent years has become publicly known as Ultra, or Magic. My base of operations was in southern England, but I had been given general responsibility for the security of Ultra and its distribution to the principal American Army and Air Headquarters in Western Europe, and this required frequent trips to the continent. By April, it had become apparent that the Third Reich was in its death throes and that a total Allied military victory in Europe was imminent. Accordingly, early that month I embarked on what I expected to be, and was, the last of my circuits around the commands that we were servicing. On about April 20th, en route to General Patton's headquarters at Erlangen in northern Bavaria, I drove through nearby Nuremberg, where I had never been before. Little of its famed beauty was to be seen. The city had been heavily bombed by the Royal Air Force in January and March, and taken, only after heavy fighting during the past few days, by General Wade Hayslip's 15th Corps. Most of the city lay in ruins, parts were still burning, and the streets were so choked with rubble that I could hardly get through. Returning to England a week later, I was met at the airfield by my colleague, Lieutenant Colonel Ted Hillis, in peacetime a distinguished professor of English literature at Yale, bringing a message to me from my superiors at the War Department in Washington. Its burden was that Robert H. Jackson, Associate Justice of the Supreme Court of the United States, had been appointed by President Truman to represent the United States as chief prosecutor at a projected international trial of war criminals to be held as soon as possible after the victorious end of hostilities. The message went on to say that Justice Jackson was assembling a legal staff to assist him and had asked that the War Department make me available for that purpose. The tone of the message suggested that the departmental authorities would be pleased if I acceded to the justice's request, but it was made clear that the decision was up to me. The proposition gave me plenty to think about, both professionally and personally. I had graduated from Harvard Law School in 1932, and during the next 10 years had held a succession of federal government legal positions. In 1939 and 1940, I had served briefly as a special assistant to the Attorney General. During those years, Jackson had been Attorney General until his appointment to the Supreme Court. I had met him a few times, heard him argue several cases, and had myself argued one case before the Supreme Court after Jackson had become a member. I was well aware of and shared the high opinion of his character and ability, which was generally held. He was a man under whom I would be proud to serve, and I had no doubt that his mission would be a unique and challenging one. On the other hand, nothing in my legal education or experience had involved international law in general or war crimes in particular. To me, it was unknown territory. Furthermore, I had not given law a thought since going into the Army in 1942, and my military duties had taken me far afield from cases and courts. I had never been in private practice and had intended, upon leaving the Army, to return to New York to get some badly needed experience in the private sector and develop an independent footing as a lawyer. At the age of 37, this was a step which should not be long postponed. As for the military side of the matter, it was plain that the Germans would surrender in a few days, and that my own mission in Europe was as good as finished. But the war against Japan was not, and it was feared that a massive invasion of the Japanese mainland might be necessary to bring about a surrender. Many of the senior American officers, particularly the regulars, were anticipating reassignment to the Pacific Theater. I myself had expected that I would soon be recalled to the Pentagon building and perhaps sent to the other war. I had no idea how near Japan was to defeat, or whether there was a place for me in the Pacific intelligence structure. But I was somewhat reluctant to get out of uniform until the war as a whole was over, and therefore I decided to ask permission to return to Washington before making a final decision about Jackson's invitation. Personal feelings and problems moved me in the same direction. My marital situation was in disarray in consequence of an intense relationship with a young Englishwoman who was married to a British officer of my acquaintance. Returning to my home in Washington might at least ease immediate tensions and allow time to try to sort things out. The Pentagon readily approved my request, so I said my farewells in England and flew to Washington, arriving home about May 22nd. During the next few days, I visited Jackson's staff headquarters and discussed the situation in the Pacific Theater with my superiors in the Intelligence Division, particularly with Colonel Alfred McCormick, in peacetime a law partner of John J. McCloy, the Assistant Secretary of War. I knew that McCormick was as well informed and otherwise equipped as anyone to assess the prospects of the war against Japan. Whether or not he was in on the secret of the atom bomb, I do not know, but he told me categorically that the Japanese military situation was hopeless, that the Emperor's advisors knew it, and that intercepted Japanese diplomatic messages revealed their anxiety to make peace. He thought it highly unlikely that an invasion of the Japanese mainland would be necessary or that the war would last much longer. As for me, McCormick said that if I wanted an assignment in the Pacific, no doubt that could be arranged, but that there was no real necessity for it. I should feel entirely free to leave the Intelligence Division and go with Jackson, or, since I had been on overseas duty for 2 years and was eligible for immediate discharge, to private law practice, as I saw fit. I had been home less than a week and already felt restless. The war had not subjected me to much danger, but the exposure to a rapidly changing succession of new places, people, and problems had been exhilarating, and in many ways rewarding. Europe was obviously on the verge of enormous change, and it would be interesting to be at the scene. I knew that before long I ought to repatriate myself and settle down to a more stable and less peripatetic life, but I simply did not feel ready for it. And so I decided to accept Justice Jackson's invitation and went back to his staff offices in the Pentagon and signed on. The unforeseen consequence was that I spent nearly 4 years in Nuremberg, the ravaged city that I had passed through 5 weeks earlier. My decision to join Jackson's staff was not influenced by any expertise or special interest in the laws of war or international law, none of which I possessed, nor was it governed by expectations of professional advancement, although I knew that the projected trial would be a major and unique affair which might bring me some publicity. But the wiser course professionally would have been to get out of uniform and into traditional legal work as soon as possible. Certainly, I was not moved by vengeful or anti-German feelings. To be sure, I detested Nazism and had been in Germany a few weeks earlier when the Dachau and Buchenwald concentration camps were captured and the inmates liberated by American troops. But like so many others, I remained ignorant of the mass extermination camps in Poland, and the full scope of the Holocaust did not dawn on me until several months later, at Nuremberg. I am not Jewish, and had, as far as I knew, no relations or close friends on the European continent. In pre-Nazi times, I had greatly enjoyed travel in Germany and Austria. Accordingly, I think it would be fair to say that my decision had virtually nothing to do with the subject matter of Jackson's mission, and that I would probably have joined any other attractive American undertaking in post-war Europe. My motivation was derived from my personal circumstances, and was, in a word, selfish. It follows that my initial adherence to the Jackson mission was not a passionate commitment. This was, indeed, a limiting factor on my effectiveness, at least during the first year of my Nuremberg tenure. But now I may at least hope that this aloofness, if so it may be called, has fostered balance and accuracy in the description and judgments presented in this memoir. In the course of the first Nuremberg trial, it became apparent that the evidence had disclosed numerous important Nazis, military leaders, and others who could best be tried by civilian tribunals. In the autumn of 1945, it was decided that later trials of such defendants would also be held at Nuremberg, and eventually 12 such trials, presided over by American judges applying international laws of war, were held during the years 1946 through 1949. I was appointed Chief of Counsel for War Crimes to serve as Chief Prosecutor of these cases, and I hope later to write a description of these subsequent trials, which involved many defendants, problems, and decisions quite different from those of the first Nuremberg trial. In the preparation of the present account of the first Nuremberg trial, I am deeply indebted to the Columbia Law School, to Jonathan Siegel, my editor at Alfred A. Knopf, to Robert Wolf of the National Archives, to Nancy Demon of the Columbia Law School for excellent secretarial assistance, and for helpful counsel to Peter Calvacoresi, Herbert Wexler, and my wife, Toby Golick. Chapter 1. Nuremberg and the Laws of War. The plan of this book is to record a personal memoir of the creation of the International Military Tribunal, IMT, and of war crimes trials held in Nuremberg from 1945 to 1946. I might have written about Nuremberg 25 or more years ago, when my own and others' memories were sharper. I had found time to write other books, so I can hardly plead lack of time or opportunity. My disinclination was partly a desire to put my mind at a distance from the subject that had engrossed me for 4 years and to turn my energies in other directions. More influential, however, was a belief that my sense and assessment of Nuremberg as a whole would benefit from the passage of time, opportunity for reflection, and the illumination that subsequent events might shed upon the past of which Nuremberg was a part. The delay has, in one respect, complicated my task. In 1945, and for 15 to 20 years thereafter, the reading public in the Western world knew a good deal about the structure and record of the Third Reich and the names of its leading personalities: Hitler, Goering, Goebbels, Ribbentrop, Himmler, among others, were household words. Today that is no longer the case. Much more by way of historical context is necessary to make such a narrative meaningful for the new generations. The events of the Nazi era were the stuff of the Nuremberg trials. Indeed, one recent and competent book about Nuremberg devotes as much space to what happened in those years as to the course of events in the Nuremberg courtroom. Since my main purpose is to tell the story of Nuremberg, I have struck a different balance, in which the history of Hitler's Reich is in the background, and the focus is on the trials and their legal and political underpinnings. I have described this book as a personal memoir, because it will portray Nuremberg as I saw, heard, and otherwise sensed it at the time, and not as a detached historian working from the documents might picture it. And apart from the legal and moral questions stirred by the Nuremberg ideas and judgments, I have sought to convey an impression of the Nuremberg participants as a community, an enclave geographically and socially of the many and varied people crowded into the enclave and following a semi-colonial lifestyle while they wrestled with the professional and personal problems that pressed upon them. I have titled my book The Anatomy of the Nuremberg Trials because it will embrace much more than the events which took place in open court. This was a complex trial which sought to break new legal ground on major issues of international law. To be sure, at the time of the trials, the defendants were the main focus of public attention, and the press was full of commentary on their personalities, their comparative degrees of guilt, and the fairness of the tribunal's judgments. But the defendants and their fates were not the reason why Nuremberg has remained a benchmark in international law and the lodestar of thought and debate on the great moral and legal questions of war and peace. Some 25 years ago, widespread controversy arose over the meaning of Nuremberg vis-à-vis the Vietnam War. Secretary of State Dean Rusk invoked Nuremberg to justify American military intervention, but thousands of young men contended, to the contrary, that under the Nuremberg principles, they were legally bound not to participate in what they regarded as the United States' aggressive war. The Nuremberg, which is remembered and invoked today, is Nuremberg as a source and test of the international law of war. While there are many who deny Nuremberg's validity as a source, they are far outweighed by the nations, international institutions, and people who have accepted Nuremberg's validity or at least looked to it for precedent and guidance. There are no permanently established means of enforcing the Nuremberg principles, and they are often flouted, but as a moral and legal statement, clothed with judicial precedent and United Nations recognition, the Nuremberg principles are an international legal force to be reckoned with. The ideas which led to the expanded principles of the Nuremberg trials were largely developed by a group of New York lawyers during the autumn and winter of 1944 through 45, most notably by Henry L. Stimson, John J. McCloy, Murray Bernays, William C. Chandler, Samuel Rosamond, Robert H. Jackson, and, though we do not usually think of him as a lawyer, President Franklin Delano Roosevelt. Initially, and in my view most important, was the decision of Stimson, then Secretary of War, to pass over the military courts-martial generally used for the trial of military crimes and establish an international court. On September 9, 1944, he wrote to the President, "I am disposed to believe that at least as to the chief Nazi officials, we should participate in an international tribunal constituted to try them." The result was the unprecedented creation of the International Military Tribunal, the most important and, I believe, successful new entity in the enforcement of the laws of war. The trial and the judgment of the tribunal were, of course, the public capstone of the Nuremberg enterprise. The subject matter, the notoriety of the defendants, and the caliber of some of the witnesses brought about many sensational and shocking revelations. I remember the stunned silence of the audience that followed the SS officer Otto Ohlendorf's cold, impassive statement that in southern Russia, his troops had rounded up and killed some 90,000 Jews. And I remember the sheer panic of the defendant Walter Funk, formerly president of the Reichsbank, German State Bank, when prosecutor Thomas Dodd, cross-examining, suddenly produced and put into evidence documents showing that Funk well knew that the Reichsbank was receiving jewels and other valuables, including gold teeth, which had been taken from the bodies of Jews and other inmates of concentration camps. But what law was the International Military Tribunal enforcing? Ordinary courts and trials are based on the statutes of sovereign nations. However, the IMT was no ordinary court. It was established by the United States and three major European nations, and the laws by which the IMT was bound were not the laws of any of those or of any other nations. For its rules on crime, the IMT looked primarily to the international laws of war, violations of which are called war crimes. Ask the passerby what the words war crimes brings to his mind, and the chances are that the reply will be Nuremberg. This may be a deserved acknowledgement of the seat of the most famous war crimes trials, but it also fosters the wholly mistaken notion that the Nuremberg trials were the original source of the laws of war. And in order to understand the anatomy of the Nuremberg trials, it is necessary, first, to know something of the nature and scope of the laws of war before and during World War II, and, second, to see what additions to the already existing laws of war those who were building the IMT sought to make. The root circumstances which gave rise to the laws of war as we know them today are part of the great waves of change that swept Western civilization in the 18th and 19th centuries, including the decline of the Church and the Holy Roman Empire, and the rise of nation-states as the main repositories of temporal power, the Industrial Revolution, and the Age of Enlightenment. Humanitarianism played a part in the development of these laws, but the prime motivations were commercial and military. They were, in fact, very largely the product of what Dwight Eisenhower, when retiring from the presidency, called the military-industrial complex. Changes in the art of war were the most immediate cause for the customs and practices, limiting the means and manners of warfare, which later turned into rules and then laws. From feudal times until well into the 17th century, armies were composed largely of mercenaries, whose pay was intermittent and who, for lack of a regular supply service, had to live off the country. This was devastating, both to the effectiveness of the armies and to the economy of nearby farms and towns. Soldiers were brutalized and undisciplined. The 30 Years' War, 1618 through 1648, left much of Europe a shambles. It is estimated that over half the German-speaking population was wiped out, and famine and pestilence were widespread. From these disastrous years, military lessons were learned. Soldiers who were regularly fed and paid, and who did not have to forage for food and shelter, could be disciplined and trained to a pitch of efficiency that greatly raised the tactical level of operations. Troops were organized under a regular chain of command, in battalions, regiments, and other standard units. Administrative staffs handled supplies, pay, and other logistical necessities. Military police helped enforce discipline, and procedures, something like courts-martial, were established to punish offenders. Thus, soldiering became a profession, and the distinction between soldier and civilian was stabilized. And so were born the customs and rules governing the conduct of occupying troops, requiring respect for the lives and livelihoods of the civilian inhabitants as long as they remained non-combatants. These rules form a major segment of the laws of war today, but of course, at the time of their origin, they were not thought of as international law, but merely as sensible military regulations. Their consequences in practical application were humane and fitted well with the libertarian and humanitarian ideas of the philosophers and publicists of the 18th century Enlightenment, the era of thinkers such as Bentham in England, and in France, Voltaire, and in particular, Jean-Jacques Rousseau. In Rousseau's opinion, warfare was legitimate only in defense against an aggressor's attack, a principle very close to those embodied today in the Charter of the United Nations. In his most famous writing, The Social Contract, 1762, Rousseau put forward the proposition that war was a relation only between states and not between individuals. War, then, is not a relation of man to man, but of state to state, in which individuals are enemies only accidentally and not as men, nor even as citizens, but as soldiers, not as members of their country, but as its defenders. The temper of the times, embodying both mercantile and philosophic values, is strikingly reflected in a letter dated November 20, 1806, to Napoleon from his foreign minister, Prince de Talleyrand. 3 centuries of civilization have given Europe a law of nations, for which human nature cannot be sufficiently grateful. According to the maxim that war is not a relation between one man and another, but between state and state, in which private persons are only accidental enemies, not as men, nor even as members or subjects of the state, but simply as its defenders, the law of nations does not permit that the rights of war and of conquest thence derived should be applied to peaceable, unarmed citizens, to private properties and dwellings, to the merchandise of commerce, to the magazines which contain it, to the vehicles which transport it, to unarmed ships which carry it on streams and seas, in one word, to the person and the goods of private individuals. The law of war, born of civilization, has favored its progress. It is to this that Europe must ascribe the maintenance and increase of her prosperity in the midst of the frequent wars that have divided her. Odd it is to find Talleyrand cribbing from Rousseau to educate Napoleon. But Talleyrand was only one of many who tapped that source to the same purpose. In 1871, the King of Prussia, marching his men into France, declared that he was fighting French soldiers, but not the French people. And this distinction between soldier and civilian, together with the soldier's obligation to respect the rights of non-combatant civilians of enemy countries, remains to this day, despite Hamburg, Dresden, Hiroshima, Tokyo, and Nagasaki, a vital part of the structure and content of the laws of war. During these same years, customs and rules for the taking and protection of prisoners of war were also developing. The wasteful stupidity of mass killings led increasingly to exchanges of prisoners. Often such exchanges were provided for in advance of hostilities. Our own 1785 treaty with Prussia provided, in the event of war, for the humane care of prisoners taken on either side. Still, it remained doubtful whether surrender into captivity was a matter of right or of grace, and whether no quarter could not be declared, at least in some circumstances. Napoleon Bonaparte, for one, took a very practical view of the matter in 1799, at the unsuccessful end of his campaign in Egypt and Palestine. In March 1799, he captured the fortress of Jaffa, where the Mamluk garrison surrendered on the promise that their lives would be spared. But the promise was not kept, and as Napoleon sailed away, Mamluks, to the number of 1,200, as he reported, or 3,500, as eyewitnesses testified, were slaughtered on the beaches of the Mediterranean. A few old rules of exception to the obligation to take prisoners lingered on, one of which is still alive today: capital punishment for spies. Well settled as it is on the basis that spies do not wear uniforms, this is an odd doctrine, as no moral obloquy now attaches to espionage. Witness the case of Nathan Hale, honored by a statue on the old campus at Yale and a plaque on the wall of the Yale Club in New York City, near his place of execution. The sporting aspect of espionage is underlined by the rule that if a spy succeeds in returning from behind the enemy lines to his own army, his responsibility for espionage is erased, and if subsequently captured, he must be treated as a prisoner of war, just as the base runner, surprised by an improbable catch, will be safe if he can beat the ball back to base. Today, the value of prisoner interrogation for intelligence purposes and the fear of reprisals have ensured among the major powers, though by no means universally, observance of the obligation to accept surrender and grant humane treatment to prisoners of war. Section 2. Although the foregoing core elements of the laws of war were in place by the middle of the 19th century, they remained uncodified. Largely unwritten in any official sense, they were known as customary law. It was the United States, during the war between the states, that took the lead in having them systemized and embodied in an officially adopted code. The principal draftsman of this first codification of the law of war was Francis Lieber, a German who, as a young man, had fought under Field Marshal von Blücher against Napoleon. A well-educated political dissident, he emigrated to the United States and took citizenship in 1832. His talents won him a professorship at South Carolina College, but he detested slavery, and in 1857 he moved to New York and became a professor at Columbia College and subsequently at the newly established Columbia Law School. The war between the states, in Lieber's words, knocked rudely at my door, for his eldest son was mortally wounded fighting for the Confederacy, whose cause Lieber abominated, while his two younger sons were in the Union Army. When one of them lost an arm in Tennessee at Fort Donelson, Lieber went west to visit him, and while there, met General Henry W. Halleck, at that time commander of the Union forces in the West. In July 1862, Halleck was appointed military advisor to President Lincoln with the title General-in-Chief. Halleck, himself the author of a treatise on international law, had been impressed by Lieber's combination of military, legal, and political pursuits, and in December 1862, he appointed Lieber to propose a code of regulations for the government of armies in the field of battle authorized by the laws and usages of war. Early in 1863, Lieber submitted a draft which was promulgated in May 1863 as General Orders No. 100, entitled Instructions for the Government of Armies of the United States in the Field. It remained, for over half a century, the official army pronouncement on the laws of land warfare. The Liber Code contains 157 brief articles, some of which read more like moral maxims than legal rules. The greater part of the code, however, reflects the history we have traced and deals with prisoners, the rights of non-combatants, partisans, and spies. In a few instances, it prohibits particular means of warfare, such as the use of poisons. The code is humanitarian in its condemnation of cruelty and unnecessary violence and destruction, but the concept of military necessity is broad. For example, it authorizes a commander to direct his troops to give no quarter in great straits when his own salvation makes it impossible to cumber himself with prisoners. In its specific content, therefore, the Liber Code did not constitute a great leap forward in a reformist sense. Its great importance was recognition of the necessity of systematizing and articulating the accumulated experience and practices of the previous century. It thus laid the basis for instruction and training of the officers and men of large wartime armies, composed chiefly of drafted civilians unfamiliar with military affairs, and established standards for compliance with the rules and for their enforcement by courts-martial and other disciplinary measures. Section 3. The provisions of the General Orders No. 100 were derived from international usage, but the orders did not purport to be international law. It was a domestic regulation of the United States Army. However, it was promulgated at a time when events in Europe, especially the Crimean, 1853 through 1856, and Franco-Austrian, 1859, wars, had raised problems which were moving the major powers toward international agreement as a means of mitigating war's ravages. Despite the progress of medical science, the warring powers in Europe had failed to make adequate provision for hospitals, doctors, and medical equipment at the scene of hostilities. In the Crimea, Florence Nightingale's administrative reforms and personal dedication to care for the wounded aroused popular feelings which were intensified in 1862 by the Swiss philanthropist Henri Dunant's widely read writings, which gave a shocking account of the neglect suffered by the wounded at the Franco-Austrian battle at Solferino in Italy in 1859. At Geneva in 1864, 12 European nations signed a convention for the amelioration of the condition of the wounded in armies in the field, the first of a series of international Red Cross conventions for this purpose. In the field of war crimes, however, the international breakthrough occurred at The Hague in 1899, when a convention with respect to the laws and customs of war on land was signed by the United States, Mexico, Japan, Persia, Siam, and 19 European nations, including all the major European powers. In both organization and content, the convention leaned heavily on the Liber Code and accordingly dealt chiefly with prisoners of war and the relations between occupation troops and non-combatant civilian inhabitants. Unlike the Liber Code, however, the convention included an unqualified prohibition of declaring no quarter or attacking enemy soldiers who have surrendered. Other conventions signed at The Hague in 1899 forbade the use of expanding dum-dum bullets, the use of projectiles containing deleterious gases, and the launching of projectiles and explosives from balloons or by other new methods of similar nature. In 1907, a second Hague Convention on the Laws of Land Warfare, differing in no major respect from the 1899 Convention, was signed by over 40 nations. In all of these treaties, the laws of war are stated as general principles of conduct, and neither the means of enforcement nor the penalties for violation are specified. However, the substance of many of their provisions was soon incorporated into the military law of the major powers and many other nations. In the United States, General Orders No. 100 was replaced in 1914 by an Army field manual entitled The Law of Land Warfare, which, updated, is still in force. It sets forth that the laws of war are part of the law of the United States and that they may be enforced against both soldiers and civilians, including enemy personnel, by military or international tribunals. Such was the state of the laws of war in 1914, when World War I began. Up to this time, the laws of war contained virtually nothing dealing with aerial warfare. The Hague Convention in 1899 antedated the Wright brothers' famous flight at Kitty Hawk in 1903, and the 1907 convention came only a few years later. Military aviation was still in its infancy in 1914 when major power warfare was renewed. The naval situation was wholly different. Over the past centuries of maritime warfare, many customs and rules, sometimes embodied in treaties, had been adopted dealing with such matters as false flags and other ruses, blockade, privateers, and the treatment of neutral shipping. The Hague meetings produced a number of agreements to internationalize both pre-existent and some new naval rules. In 1907, no less than 8 naval conventions were adopted, covering such matters as the status of enemy ships at the outbreak of hostilities, the converting of merchant ships into warships, mine laying, and coastal bombardment. Most of these rules were of such a nature that their violation would lead to reprisals, or claims for compensation, rather than criminal prosecutions. Navies do not ordinarily occupy enemy territory, nor take large quantities of prisoners. These factual differences no doubt explain why there was no general naval code comparable to the Hague Conventions on land warfare. None of the Hague Conventions, nor the predecessor concepts on which they were based, imposed any limitation on the sovereign right to make war. Wars had played a large part in the rise and proliferation of nation-states, whose leaders generally scorned as sentimental rubbish the just and unjust war concept of earlier centuries. To be sure, governments might still give reasons for resorting to war that stressed the righteousness of their cause, but none of this was of any legal significance. Lieber, progressive as he was with regard to the conduct of warfare, had no doubts about its intrinsic validity, and accordingly, General Orders No. 100 declared that war has come to be acknowledged not to be its own end, but the means to obtain great ends of state. Therefore, the laws of nations allows every sovereign government to make war upon another sovereign state. And the nation attacked is bound to abide by the laws of war, even though it regards the enemy as a wanton and unjust assailant. And so, in 1914, when the guns of August thundered, there was nothing in the acknowledged content of international law that made any state or individual liable to criminal charges for declaring and engaging in war. But the Hague Conventions and other treaties and conclaves in the preceding half century had internationalized the whole subject of limits on warfare and laid the basis for an extraordinary expansion of public and political concern with war crimes throughout the course and aftermath of World War I. Section 4. From the very beginning of that war, Kaiser Wilhelm II and his general staff contrived to conduct German war operations in such a way as to raise a worldwide storm of hate and fear, almost comparable to that achieved by Adolf Hitler a quarter of a century later. I use the word contrived advisedly, for whereas the Hitlerian atrocities reflected fundamental Nazi doctrine, the crimes and errors of Imperial Germany appear to have been the result of clumsiness, arrogance, and sheer brutality. Historians still debate the apportionment of responsibility for the onset of World War I, but no one contends that Belgium started it by attacking Germany. The German High Command conceived that their forces needed the deployment space of Belgium for a speedy victory over France, and as soon as there was a state of war between Germany and France, the German government sent Belgium a demand to allow the transit of German troops. When the Belgians declined, the German army attacked across the Belgian frontier, in violation of the multinational Belgian Neutrality Treaty of 1839, which the German Chancellor, Theobald von Bethmann-Hollweg, publicly scorned as a scrap of paper. A few hours later, Britain, invoking the 1839 treaty, declared war on Germany. The Germans' ruthless attack on a small neutral country not only ensured British hostility, but also scandalized world opinion. With the invasion came reports of wanton destruction and brutalities by the Germans. The ancient city of Louvain was sacked, and its world-famous library destroyed by fire. Innocent civilians were taken hostage and often shot. In some places, the invading soldiers were said to have raped women and killed adults and children alike. Soon, there were comparable reports from German-occupied areas in France, where the troops of a brigade, commanded by General Karl Stenger, had denied quarter to French soldiers, including the wounded. During 1915, the pitch of public indignation climbed even higher. In January, the huge German lighter-than-air ships, known after their designer as Zeppelins, started bombing raids over England. Their military value was slight, but by the end of the year, over 200 civilians had been killed and many were terrorized. The following month, the German government proclaimed a war zone around the British Isles, in which their submarines would sink enemy merchant ships without warning. In April, the huge Cunard liner Lusitania was sunk by a U-boat off the Irish coast with the loss of some 1,200 lives. That same month, the Germans first employed poison gas as a weapon during the Battle of Ypres. At about the same time, the Young Turk government of the Ottoman Empire, which had entered the war as an ally of Germany in November 1914, began the deportation of Armenians to the Syrian desert, where they were massacred by the thousands. In October, the British public was enraged by the Germans' execution of Edith Cavell, the director of a nurses' training school in Brussels. The following night, a Zeppelin raid over London killed 127 inhabitants. This list, far from complete, of German and Turkish actions is certainly adequate to explain why, in both Allied and neutral nations, the Germans came to be referred to as Huns and their military policies as frightfulness. But in nearly every case, there were serious evidentiary or legal questions whether these acts could rightly be labeled war crimes. The neutrality treaty violated by the German invasion of Belgium did not embody criminal sanctions, and as soon as Belgium resisted, she ceased to be neutral. As for the conduct of German troops in Belgium, most of the stories of indiscriminate murder, rape, and infanticide were later exposed as the fabrications of propagandists. The destruction in Louvain, to be sure, was plainly contrary to several clauses of the Hague Convention, but the taking and even killing of hostages was not so covered, and as late as 1948 was held permissible under the laws of war by one of the Nuremberg tribunals. Edith Cavell publicly acknowledged that in the autumn of 1914, she had been part of an underground railway to assist Allied soldiers trapped behind the German lines to escape capture and rejoin their compatriots. Her execution was draconian, and from a public relations standpoint, stupid, but it was no war crime. The Zeppelin raids ushered in the era of urban bombardment from the air, but violated no law of war. The Hague Conventions on Land Warfare forbade the bombardment of undefended cities, but London was not undefended. The separate 1907 Hague Convention prohibiting the discharge of explosives from balloons or by other new methods of a similar nature was not in force, as neither Germany nor France had signed it. No international agreement governing submarine operations had been adopted, and, except for hospital ships, German U-boat attacks on enemy shipping violated no international law, save in the few cases in which survivors of a sinking ship were attacked. However, the use of poison gas was much less defensible, as the Hague Convention on Land Warfare explicitly forbade the use of poison or poisoned arms. But even here, questions might be raised under the Hague Convention on asphyxiating or deleterious gases, which was limited to their diffusion by the use of projectiles. The Armenians were citizens of the Ottoman Empire. There was no formal state of war between Armenians and Turks, and so the Hague Conventions were wholly inapplicable. In May 1915, a joint Allied declaration denounced the Turkish actions as crimes against humanity and civilization, but that was a concept quite outside the scope of any treaties or recognized doctrine. Section 5. Such negative arguments were overwhelmed by the tide of anger against Imperial Germany, which engulfed the Allied and many neutral peoples. Initially, public rage focused on the Kaiser. Before the war was a month old, there were published demands for his exile to St. Helena, Devil's Island, or some other suitable place. Almost as soon, however, voices were raised insisting upon trial and punishment by law, preferably before an international tribunal. Pressure for punitive action against the Kaiser and other German war criminals was strongest in Britain, which was bearing the brunt of the U-boat and Zeppelin operations. In 1916, Prime Minister Herbert Asquith told the House of Commons that his government was determined to bring to justice the criminals, whoever they may be, and whatever their station. In February 1917, the German government declared a new zone around the British Isles in which U-boats would sink enemy and neutral shipping alike, without warning or regard for the safety of crews or passengers. This was so contrary to maritime practice and so hazardous to American lives and property that 2 months later, the United States declared war against Germany. A year later, over 1 million American soldiers had joined the Allied forces in France. Since American sympathies had lain with the Allies from the beginning of the war, it is not surprising that in the United States there had been almost as much discussion of war crimes trials as in Britain. In both countries, the general public's wrath was directed at the Kaiser, but in legal and academic circles, there was a strong current of opinion that judicial trials would promote the development of international law as an instrument of peace. This fitted well with Wilsonian internationalism and the president's insistence that the war was a crusade, a war to end war, and to make the world safe for democracy. When victory came via the armistice in November 1918, it was accompanied by the Kaiser's flight to Holland, a country with a long tradition as a haven for political refugees. This was a complicating factor, but did nothing to quell the public demand for his punishment. In Britain, Prime Minister David Lloyd George and his cabinet pledged support for a trial of the Kaiser as part of their successful parliamentary election campaign in December 1918. In France, the public appetite for war crimes trials had increased, partly because the Germans had carried out what amounted to a scorched-earth policy in their final retreat through northern France. The practical French were, however, much more concerned about reparations and future national security than international justice. As for the Kaiser, he was one of the guilty, but there was opposition to his exile to St. Helena, a proposal which was condemned as an insult to Napoleon and the French nation. There was no unity of viewpoint about war crimes among the three major powers when the delegates assembled on January 18, 1919, at the opening session of the Paris Peace Conference, a conclave dominated by Lloyd George, Georges Clemenceau, and Woodrow Wilson. For the first named, the establishment of an international tribunal to try the Kaiser and provisions for the trial and punishment of other war criminals was both a political necessity and a program which reflected his own and a majority of his countrymen's strong desires. But for both Clemenceau and Wilson, war crimes were collateral to their larger aims. For Clemenceau, reparations and security. For Wilson, a moderate peace, a viable democratic government for Germany, and most of all, a League of Nations to secure future peace. The war crimes issue was the first item on the conference's agenda, and a commission on the responsibility of the authors of the war and the enforcement of penalties was established to study and report back on the matter. The chairman and dominant figure was the American Secretary of State, Robert Lansing, whose views on war crimes issues were fiercely conservative. He did not really believe in any supranational law and opposed any international punitive action against the Kaiser or the establishment of international courts for war crimes trials. The commission's report, submitted in March 1919, charged Germany and her allies, the Central Powers, with extensive violations of the laws of war. Some offenders could be tried before national tribunals, but those in high authority and responsible for crimes on a large scale would be brought before a 22-member international high tribunal. The commission also found that the Central Powers had, with premeditation, launched a war of aggression in violation of treaties, but that this conduct did not provide the basis for a criminal charge under existing international law. It should, however, be strongly condemned and made a penal offense for the future. As for the Kaiser, the commission recommended his trial before an international tribunal on the charge that he was responsible for German violations of the laws of war. The report was nominally unanimous, but the American reservations were so fundamental that they amounted to a dissent. President Wilson was not as rigid as Lansing on these issues, but he was worried about Victor's justice and had told Lansing that he wanted a minority report rejecting high tribunal and opposing trial of the Kaiser. Lloyd George, however, made it clear that he could not sign a treaty that failed to provide for the Kaiser's punishment. Confrontation then gave way to compromise, embodied in Articles 227 and 230 of the Treaty of Versailles, signed in June 1919. Under Article 227, the Kaiser was to be tried before a special tribunal of five judges, one each from the United States, Great Britain, France, Italy, and Japan. He was not to be charged with responsibility for war crimes, but with a supreme offense against international morality and the sanctity of treaties. The three ensuing articles called for trials of persons accused of having committed acts in violation of the laws and customs of war before military tribunals of the aggrieved nations, and required the German government to hand over the individuals so accused to any of the Allied and associated powers so requesting. Provisions comparable to Articles 228 through 230 were included in the later peace treaties with Austria, Hungary, and Bulgaria. Thus, the hopes of Lloyd George and other European statesmen to use the victorious peace as an occasion for confirming and expanding the international law of war foundered on the rocks of American opposition. Wilson and Lansing had won. There would be no international war crimes courts. There would be no trial to determine the Kaiser's criminal guilt. The charge against him was stated in terms that were opaque and had no roots in international legal doctrine. Furthermore, this boded ill for the prospects of persuading the Dutch to make him available for trial. Section 6. President Wilson left France the day after the Versailles Treaty was signed and embarked on his unsuccessful campaign to obtain Senate ratification. His eventual failure in March 1920 was followed by his severe illness, and Washington's role in treaty matters rapidly dwindled. America's virtual withdrawal weakened both the League of Nations and the treaty, and the European allies soon learned that it is one thing to get a treaty signed and quite another to enforce it. Holland was duly asked to make the Kaiser available for trial, but the Allied camp was divided on the wisdom of the project, and the Dutch received hints that the demand was pro forma and there would be no coercion. The Allied request was refused on the legal ground that the offense charged against the Kaiser was unknown to Dutch law, was not mentioned in any treaties to which Holland was a party, and appeared to be of a political rather than a criminal character. The Kaiser never left Holland and died in his castle at Doorn in 1941. No part of the Versailles Treaty aroused more anger in Germany than Article 228. Requiring the government to deliver up its own citizens for trial on war crimes charges before tribunals constituted by the victorious army. Credible information reached the Allied leaders that compliance with such demands would threaten the stability of the Weimar Republic and might even lead to a communist takeover. Lloyd George and Clemenceau were deeply troubled. There was strong demand from their respective publics for strict enforcement of Article 228, but it was obvious that revolution in Germany would jeopardize reparations and have other serious consequences. Nevertheless, on February 3, 1920, the Allies presented to the Germans a list of 854 individuals, including many famous military and political figures, for turnover. there was an immediate explosion of indignation and defiance in Germany. But within 2 weeks, the immediate crisis was resolved. Accurately sensing Allied misgivings, the Germans had come forward with a proposal that those accused of war crimes be tried before the German Supreme Court in Leipzig. Lloyd George prevailed on the French to accept this solution, and on February 17, 1920, the Germans were so notified. The Allies then presented the Germans with an initial list of 45 individuals for prosecution, and a year later, the Leipzig trials began. The first accused were four named by the British, three German enlisted men charged with beating British prisoners with rifle butts were convicted and given sentences of 6 to 10 months. A U-boat commander who had sunk a British hospital ship was acquitted on the ground of superior orders. The court then heard a Belgian case against a German military policeman charged with torturing small children arrested on suspicion of sabotage. The court acquitted the defendant. The Belgians at once repudiated the trials and refused further participation. The Leipzig court then took up the case of General Stenger and his subordinate, Major Crusius, on the charge of denying quarter and murdering French prisoners. Major Crusius admitted shooting French wounded and accused General Stenger of ordering the killings. Stenger denied the charge and was acquitted. Crusius was sentenced to 2 years' imprisonment. The trial was turbulent, and the French delegates were taunted and spat upon by the crowd. Four other Germans accused by the French were then acquitted. The French withdrew their delegation and participated no further. The British had listed for trial Lieutenant Patzig, commander of a U-boat which had sunk a hospital ship and then destroyed two lifeboats with survivors. Patzig was unavailable for trial, but the German prosecutor, on his own initiative, brought charges against two subordinates, Lieutenants Dittmar and Bolt. The court ruled that they well knew that Patzig's order to attack the lifeboats was unlawful, convicted them of manslaughter, and sentenced them to 4 years' imprisonment. Within a few months, both escaped, apparently with the connivance of the jailers. Dismal as the Leipzig record was from a prosecution standpoint, the British did not share the outrage of the French and Belgians and refused to join in French proposals for sanctions. By way of compromise, however, in August 1922, the British joined in an Allied note to Germany declaring that the Leipzig court's decisions would not be recognized as valid and reserving all rights under Articles 228 through 230 of the Versailles Treaty. There were few other post-World War I war crimes trials worthy of note. A French court convicted two prominent Saarland industrialists, Robert and Hermann Reuschling, of wartime spoliation of French-owned property, but the verdict was set aside on appeal. The Allies showed no interest in pursuing war criminals in Austria or Hungary. Among the victorious Balkan states, only Yugoslavia pressed for the punishment of war criminals, in this instance, Bulgarians. Eager for good relations with the Yugoslavs, the Bulgarian government brought to trial and convicted a number of its own soldiers for crimes against Yugoslav civilians. Allied, and especially British, interest in Turkish crimes was much greater, with regard both to the Armenian massacres and to the mistreatment of British prisoners. The Sultan's government was submissive to Allied demands, and in April 1919, a Turkish military tribunal convicted two officials, one of whom went to the gallows, of murdering Armenians. But the Turkish nationalist movement was growing, and Greek atrocities against Turks in Smyrna put a hypocritical cast on the war crimes issue. The word genocide had not yet been coined, but that is what the Armenian massacres were. The Allies failed to establish the criminality of the massacres by judicial process, and in 1923, the Treaty of Lausanne covered the perpetrators with the shield of amnesty. As for the war crimes provisions of the Versailles Treaty, the best that can be said is that the mountain labored and brought forth a mouse. Thus, the war crimes prosecutions moved off stage, but the enormous carnage of World War I stimulated public demand for measures to prevent a recurrence of such slaughter and destruction. Military and diplomatic interest was rekindled in the use of multinational treaties not only to limit armaments, but also to govern their use. The airplane, the submarine, and poison gas had profoundly affected the conduct of war, and it was to these relatively new weapons, largely untouched by the Hague Conventions, that attention now turned. The first efforts, at the five-power Washington Conference of 1922 on the limitation of armaments, failed. The conference also found it impossible to formulate a treaty limiting aerial warfare, but provided for a commission of jurists to study and report on the problem. Early in 1923, the commission submitted proposed rules which included a prohibition against bombardment for the purposes of terrorizing the civilian population and limiting aerial bombing to specified military objectives. The rules were never adopted in legally binding form. Success in these areas was first achieved by the prohibition against the use of poison gas in the 1925 Geneva Protocol, which was soon ratified by most nations and generally recognized as legally binding. The United States, however, did not ratify the protocol until 1975, and both the United States and Great Britain have expressed reservations about its application to tear gas and herbicides. The 1930 London Treaty for the Limitation of Naval Armaments, signed by 11 nations, provided that, with regard to merchant ships, submarines must conform to the rules of international law to which surface vessels are subjected, and explicitly required that, unless the merchant ship refused to stop or attacked the submarine, it could not be sunk unless the passengers, crew, and ship's papers had first been put in a place of safety, with due regard to location and sea and weather conditions. In 1936, pursuant to the London Protocol of that year, these rules were circulated to all other nations, and by the time World War II began, it had been accepted by 48 countries, including Germany and all other major powers. For air warfare, there were no further treaty developments, and in retrospect, it is easy to see why the 1923 draft failed to win adherence. In 1921, the Italian Air General Giulio Duete had published a widely read book, Command of the Air, preaching the doctrine that in future years air power would be decisive, a view congenial to the British Air Staff, which soon was planning a large investment in heavy bombers as the best deterrent to German air attacks against the homeland. The United States was similarly developing the four-engined B-17 and B-24 strategic range bombers that were to play a major role in World War II. Public opinion, during the years between the two world wars, settled into a fatalistic acceptance that future wars between the great powers would surely involve urban infernos produced by bombers and that nothing could be done about it. So firm was this belief that, when such attacks failed to materialize during the first months of World War II, people called it the phony war. Of more general importance than these discussions and agreements was the 1928 Treaty of Paris, which sought to outlaw war itself. The late 1920s was a period of international amity, which had begun in 1925 with the Locarno Security Pact among Britain, France, Germany, Belgium, and Italy, guaranteeing the German-French and German-Belgian frontiers. The foreign ministers of France and Germany, Aristide Briand and Gustave Stresemann, were seeking to allay old animosities. The French ended their occupation of the Ruhr, Germany resumed reparations payments, and in 1926 was admitted to the League of Nations. That year, the two men shared the Nobel Peace Prize. The 10th anniversary of the United States' entry into World War I fell on April 6, 1927, and Briand proposed to celebrate the occasion by a mutual undertaking by the two countries to renounce war. The American Secretary of State, Frank B. Kellogg, proposed making such a treaty multilateral. Then on August 27, 1928, the representatives of 15 nations met at Paris and signed the International Treaty for the Renunciation of War as an Instrument of National Policy, better known today as the Kellogg-Briand Pact, and providing as follows. Article 1. The high contracting parties solemnly declare in the names of their respective peoples that they condemn recourse to war for the solution of international controversies and renounce it as an instrument of national policy in their relations with one another. Article 2. The high contracting parties agree that the settlement or solution of all disputes or conflicts of whatever nature or of whatever origin they may be, which may arise among them, shall never be sought except by pacific means. The treaty was subsequently accepted by 44 nations, including all the great powers except the Soviet Union. It certainly was an impressive anti-war commitment. But did it make engaging in war a crime? Of course, it was not intended to condemn resorting to war and self-defense, but what about launching an aggressive war? Opinions differed sharply at the time, and still did when World War II brought the question to a head. In summary, one could say that when that war ended in 1945, except for the treaty provisions relating to poison gas and submarines, the declared and generally accepted laws of war were not fundamentally different from those embodied in the Hague and Geneva Conventions. But one would have to put that statement in perspective by adding that, in 1945, public and official attitudes toward the laws of war had undergone a sea change. The reasons for this will become apparent in the immediate background of the Nuremberg trials. Chapter 2. The Nuremberg Ideas. In sharp contrast to the aftermath of World War I, that of World War II witnessed an explosion of war crimes trials in both Europe and the Far East. The differences can be explained in part by the changing outlook of the late 1920s, reflected in international agreements such as the Kellogg-Briand Pact. A more important reason was that the perceived evil of Nazism in action was far deeper and more pervasive than was that of Imperial Germany. In World War I, U-boats, zeppelins, and poison gas had been brutally and ruthlessly used, but they were weapons of war employed to achieve military victory. The ideology of the Third Reich, however, embraced not only German aggrandizement by force of arms, but also the violent suppression of political opposition and reduction of Jews and Slavs to the status of subhumans targeted for enslavement at best. Nazism was a proudly avowed repudiation of the libertarian, humanitarian, and internationalist ideals to which most national governments gave at least lip service. In Germany, the period between Hitler's ascent to power in 1933 and the attack on Poland in 1939 included the establishment of concentration camps, in which communists, social democrats, royalists, and other opponents of the Nazi regime were incarcerated, establishment of a totalitarian dictatorship by imposing Nazi Party control over labor unions, professional business associations, and other public organizations, destruction of the rule of law by Nazifying the judiciary and according Hitler as supreme judge the power to direct the imprisonment or execution of individuals with no semblance of a trial, and the progressive outlawing of Jews by their expulsion from all positions of private or public authority and, under the 1935 Nuremberg laws, by depriving them of the rights of German citizenship and making marriage or sexual intimacy between Jews and German citizens a criminal offense. As for foreign policy, Hitler pulled Germany out of the League of Nations and the 1932 Geneva Disarmament Conference, repudiated the Treaty of Versailles military provisions, launched a vigorous rearmament program, cultivated his fellow dictator Benito Mussolini, and drew Italy, and subsequently Japan, into alliance with Germany. In March 1938, by brutal diplomatic pressure subsequently sharpened by the threat of military force, Austria was annexed to the Reich. 6 months later, with the Wehrmacht deployed along the German-Czech border and poised for invasion, at the famous Munich Conference, Czechoslovakia was rendered defenseless by the forced cession of the Sudetenland to Germany. In March of 1939, just a year after the annexation of Austria, German troops occupied Prague, and Hitler proclaimed the incorporation of Bohemia and Moravia into the Reich as a protectorate, while Slovakia preserved a precarious autonomy as an avowed satellite of Germany. None of these events prior to September 1, 1939, touched off a war, yet the systematic, state-mandated mistreatment of the Jews, including such horrifying excesses as Kristallnacht, November 10, 1938, when there was an orgy of looting, arson, harassment of Jews, and destruction of synagogues, homes, and businesses, with many arrests and some killings, had raised the same question as the earlier Turkish massacres of Armenians. Are such actions by a state against a racial or religious segment of its own citizenry crimes under international law? The German takeover of Czechoslovakia, though accomplished without any fighting, was plainly the result of a threat of war. Was that not, within the spirit if not the letter of the Kellogg-Briand Pact, an aggressive act? These questions had to be addressed as Allied victory in World War II became increasingly probable, and war crimes policies had to be shaped. However, no such difficulties surrounded the German invasion of Poland in September 1939 and the speedy destruction of the Polish government and occupation of most of its territory by German and Soviet troops. If launching an aggressive war was to be regarded as an international crime, this was it. The provisions of the Hague and Geneva Conventions thus became applicable, and violations of the Germans' obligations to the Polish civilian populations were therefore plainly war crimes, and crimes of hideous intent and effect multiplied. Under German administration, the Poles were to be allowed only bare living conditions, so that no indigenous Polish leadership could develop. The moneyed and cultured classes, including intellectuals, landowners, and clergy, were to be stamped out. Jews, wherever located, would be resettled in ghettos established in the larger cities. For Germany, the government general was regarded as useful only as a military deployment area and a source of cheap slave labor. "The accomplishment of this task," said Hitler, "will involve a hard racial struggle which will not allow any legal restrictions. The methods used will be incompatible with the principles we otherwise adhere to." As these murderous policies were put into effect, many of the German soldiers in Poland watched with incredulous horror. In November 1939, a young German staff officer, Major Helmut Stief, wrote to his wife, "When one has seen the ruins of Warsaw, one feels not like a victor, but as a guilty man. The wildest fantasy of horror propaganda is as nothing to the reality. The organized gangs who murder, rob, and plunder with what is said to be the tolerance of the highest authorities. It shames me to be a German." Higher-ranking officers were indignant not only at the savagery, but also at what appeared to them the stupidity of these atrocities. In December 1939, General Johannes Blaskowitz, commander-in-chief of all German military forces in the government general, sent a stinging criticism of the German civil and police administration to the Army High Command in Berlin. A few months later, Blaskowitz was relieved of his command, his career blighted. News of these events came to the outside world in January 1940, when the Primate of Poland, August Cardinal Hlound, visited Rome, where he reported that 214 Catholic priests had been executed and some 1,000 imprisoned by the Nazis in Poland. But soon after the broadcast of Hlound's report on the Vatican radio station, the German ambassador to the Holy See was able to inform Berlin that the broadcasts had been stopped. Public attention soon shifted in other directions during the spring of 1940. When the Wehrmacht struck north and west and occupied Denmark, Norway, Luxembourg, Holland, and Belgium. France was then forced to accept an armistice under which northern France, including Paris, fell under German occupation. The following year, Yugoslavia and Greece were added to the list, shortly before Hitler launched his last and most massive assault against the Soviet Union. In November 1942, when British and American forces landed in Algeria and Morocco, the Germans occupied the rest of France. Section 2. And so all of Europe, except Sweden, Switzerland, and the Iberian Peninsula, fell under occupation and administration by Germany or its satellites, Italy, Hungary, Romania, and Bulgaria, all referred to collectively as the Axis powers. Festung Europa, Fortress Europe, it came to be called, and from the fortress all normal sources of news were cut off. But information did come out through refugees, clandestine agents, neutral travelers, and other sources. And in London, quite apart from British intelligence agencies, there was a most unusual group of persons to whom much of this information was directed and who eagerly collected and recorded it, a group that had no parallel during World War I. The first members were fugitive Polish military and civil officials who, after the defeat of France, established a Polish government in exile in London, with General Władysław Sikorski as premier. Simultaneously, there came a procession of monarchs and ministers fleeing the German invasions of their respective countries. King Haakon of Norway, Grand Duchess Charlotte of Luxembourg, Queen Wilhelmina of the Netherlands, the émigré ministers of Belgium, ex-president Edvard Beneš of Czechoslovakia, and General Charles de Gaulle, leader of the Free French Forces. In 1941, they were joined by King Peter of Yugoslavia and King George of Greece. By the end of 1941, there were 9 governments in exile established in London, amassing information on how matters were going in their respective countries under German rule. In general, the answer was very badly in Western Europe and far, far worse in Eastern Europe. Early in 1940, the United States Embassy in Berlin transmitted news of the wholesale deportation of German Jews to Poland. In the wake of the Nazi conquests of 1940 and 1941, came reports describing the roundup of millions of men and women from all the occupied countries for forced labor on German farms and in German mines and factories. In the course of invading the Soviet Union, German military orders declared that the supply of food to local inhabitants and prisoners of war is unnecessary humanitarianism and ordered all things of value confiscated, including children's boots. Soviet prisoners in German hands froze and starved to death by the millions. And in 1942 came the reports, at first deemed incredible but soon confirmed, of the mass extermination of Jews from all the occupied countries at Auschwitz, Treblinka, and other death camps in Poland. The Nazis' final solution of the Jewish problem, later called the Holocaust. These outrages were not the work of faceless or anonymous men or agencies. A decade of Nazi rule had made the names of Hitler's principal associates and the organizations through which they worked household words in the Western world. Especially familiar to the public at large, inside and beyond German borders, were Hermann Göring, Commander-in-Chief of the Air Force and Chief of War Economy, and designated by Hitler as his own successor, Rudolf Hess, deputy to Hitler for Nazi Party matters and successor designate in the event of Göring's unavailability, Heinrich Himmler, head of the black-uniformed SS, Schutzstaffel, the Nazi Party's police, intelligence, and security organizations, including the concentration and death camps, the diminutive, club-footed Dr. Josef Goebbels, Minister of Public Enlightenment and Propaganda, Hans Frank, the Governor-General in Poland, Hjalmar Horace Greeley Schacht, the banker who had supported Hitler's accession to the chancellorship and directed the financing of rearmament until his replacement by Göring, Joachim von Ribbentrop, foreign minister, Julius Streicher, regional leader in Franconia and editor-in-chief of the lascivious anti-Semitic newspaper Der Stürmer, Fritz Sauckel, head of the forced labor program, and Albert Speer, Hitler's favorite architect and, subsequently, director of the armaments program. What was to be done about these men publicly regarded as murderous villains and their terrorist organizations? During the first 2 years of the war, as Britain's allies were bowled over like so many tenpins and Britain herself clung to survival by her fingernails, there was little time to spare for consideration of war crimes. Then, on October 25th, 1941, President Roosevelt and Prime Minister Churchill simultaneously issued statements condemning the Germans' execution of scores of innocent hostages and other atrocities in the occupied territories. Retribution for these crimes was envisaged, but the statements did not address any of the many problems which this prospect presented. On January 13, 1942, moved by the need for concerted action, representatives of the 9 governments in exile met at St. James's Palace in London, organized themselves as the Inter-Allied Commission on the Punishment of War Crimes, and issued what became known as the Declaration of St. James's. The salient feature of the declaration was that it explicitly repudiated retribution by acts of vengeance on the part of the general public and declared that the sense of justice of the civilized world required that the signatory powers place among their principal war aims the punishment, through the channel of organized justice, of those guilty of or responsible for these crimes, whether they have ordered them, perpetrated them, or participated in them. Of course, this was only a beginning, but it was the war's first principled utterance about war crimes, and it was accurately predictive. The leaders of these German-occupied lands, on whose peoples the burden of the atrocities directly fell, did not merely want to see the heads of their oppressors roll. They wanted vindication and retribution by law applied through judicial process. And so it was to be. In July 1942, evidence of new German atrocities in hand, the St. James's signatory powers sought public support from the Big Three, Churchill, Roosevelt, and Stalin. In reply, Churchill and Roosevelt explicitly approved the proposal that those accused of war crimes should stand trial, while Stalin referred to such trials before a special international tribunal. Meanwhile, the phrases United Nations had been adopted to signal the alliance of Britain, the United States, the Soviet Union, China, and 22 other nations against the tripartite pact powers, Germany, Italy, and Japan. On October 7, 1942, in simultaneous but separate statements, President Roosevelt and the British Lord Chancellor, Sir John Simon, proposed the establishment of a United Nations Commission for the Investigation of War Crimes to identify war crimes suspects and collect and organize evidence of and about war crimes. The necessity for some such organization was greatly sharpened on December 17, 1942, when, in a joint declaration by the United States and the European members of the United Nations, the German government was publicly and officially accused of a bestial policy of extermination of the Jewish people in Europe, in accordance with Hitler's oft-repeated intention. The Soviet Union did not become party to the commission. The United Nations War Crimes Commission, UNWCC, was organized in London as a 14-member body, comprising the 9 governments in exile, the United Kingdom, United States, China, Australia, and India. At the first meeting, on January 11, 1944, the British Commissioner, Sir Cecil Hurst, was elected chairman. He had for many years been legal advisor to the Foreign Office, and his selection as the British Commissioner betokened London's belief that the war crimes problem was as much a diplomatic as a legal one. The United States Commissioner, Herbert C. Pell, was a New York Democrat and friend of Roosevelt. The UNWCC was politically weak. A majority of its members represented scented shadow governments, who might or might not be restored to power when their countries were liberated. Even as the commission was being organized, there came a pronouncement from a much higher level which significantly limited the prospective scope of its work. On November 1, 1943, at the Moscow Conference of the Foreign Ministers of Britain, the United States, and the Soviet Union, a declaration on war crimes was promulgated over the names of Churchill, Roosevelt, and Stalin, speaking in behalf of the United Nations. The last paragraph of the Moscow Declaration struck a new note. The above declaration is without prejudice to the case of the major criminals whose offenses have no particular location and who will be punished by a joint decision of the governments of the Allies. This, in practical effect, removed the principal Nazi leaders from the jurisdiction of the UNWCC. The fate of these major criminals and the important issues associated with their punishment would not be decided by the UNWCC, but by consultation among the Allied governments, which, as a practical matter, meant Britain, the United States, the Soviet Union, and perhaps France. In fact, the UNWCC was in for a very thin time. It was supposed to investigate and collect evidence of war crimes, but it had no investigatory staff, or, for that matter, adequate staff for any substantial undertaking. The governments in exile had but meager resources. The commission could do little but record cases referred to it by the member governments. Of these, there was a mere trickle. On March 30, 1944, Sir Cecil Hurst reported that the UNWCC had no more than half a dozen cases that could reasonably be regarded as atrocities. Sir Cecil confessed that no evidence of the massacre of Jews in Poland had been received by the commission, and this 15 months after the foreign minister's public disclosure that proof of such massacres was in the British government's hands. In these frustrating operational circumstances, the members turned their attention to legal issues and considered at length such questions as whether launching an aggressive war should be considered a crime of international law, whether an atrocity committed by a government against its own citizens, frequently described as a crime against humanity, should be regarded as an international crime, and whether an international tribunal should be created for the trial of war criminals, especially those charged with crimes described in the Moscow Declaration as having no particular geographical location. These issues had all been raised after World War I, and the discussions in London in 1944 closely tracked those 25 years earlier. But neither of the other two questions could be resolved. On the issue of the criminality of aggressive warfare, the members of the commission were sharply split. In December 1944, when the problem came before the full commission, the members were so evenly divided that no consensus could be reached, and no resolution was ever adopted. The situation with crimes against humanity was more complicated. Herbert Pell, no doubt sensitive to ethnic factors in New York politics, took the lead in espousing the view that crimes committed against any persons because of their race or religion, and especially Nazi atrocities against German Jews and Catholics, should be punishable as war crimes. A State Department official privately informed the Foreign Office that Pell was ignorant of law and difficult and had no authority to take this position. Pell's démarche also provoked a personal letter to him from the president, one of Roosevelt's very few interventions on the details of war crimes policies, expressing the opinion that UNWCC jurisdiction comprised cases arising during the war period, while pre-war atrocities, since they may not fall within the category of war crimes, would have to be dealt with by the United Nations. Pell's initiative, however, had won considerable support within the commission, and in May 1944, a draft resolution in line with his opinion was presented for consideration. Apart from the merits of the matter, there was great doubt that the member governments would accept Pell's views, and in consequence, Sir Cecil addressed a letter of inquiry to the British government. In November 1944, the Foreign Office replied that the Commission should stay within the traditional definitions of war crimes, and so the matter rested until the end of the war. The UNWCC had become a pretty discouraging place to work, and at the end of the year, Pell resigned and was replaced by the less volatile Colonel J.V. Hodgson. Sir Cecil Hurst resigned on health grounds and was succeeded as chairman by the Australian Commissioner, Lord Wright of Durley, who remained a respected figure in war crimes activities. However, the UNWCC played no significant role in shaping the Nuremberg enterprise. The major contribution of the governments in exile was their first act, promulgation of the St. James's Declaration, with its decisive emphasis on judicial process as the only acceptable procedure for the trial of persons accused of war crimes. Section 3. On November 12, 1942, Ivan Maisky, the Soviet ambassador to Britain, sent a note to the Foreign Secretary, Anthony Eden, suggesting that an international tribunal be established for the trial of major war criminals. There was, at that time, only one such person actually in custody, Rudolf Hess, who had made a dramatic solo flight from Germany to Britain on May 10, 1941, in the vain hope of persuading the British to negotiate peace with Germany. Eden sharply rejected Maisky's proposal as premature. Nonetheless, the proposal for an international tribunal had an importance much more general than that of the Hess case. Several months before Maisky made his proposal, the Foreign Office staff had circulated a memorandum opposing the establishment of any tribunal for the trial of arch-criminals such as Himmler on the ground that their guilt was so black that it was beyond the scope of any judicial process. Lord Simon, the Lord Chancellor, was mindful of the views expressed in the St. James's Declaration and doubted that summary execution of the major Nazis would satisfy public opinion or achieve a measure of substantial justice. But he soon came around to the opinion, strongly held by Eden and Churchill, that while national tribunals for the trial of lesser individuals accused of violating the laws of war would be entirely proper, the creation of an international war crimes tribunal should be strongly opposed, and that the principal Nazi leaders should be dealt with by a political decision of the Allied powers. This was, of course, a complete reversal of the war crimes policies which Britain had pursued after World War I, when Prime Minister Lloyd George had pressed vigorously for the establishment of international tribunals to try the Kaiser and other German leaders. These efforts had been blocked by American opposition, and ultimately the whole war crimes undertaking was trivialized by the fiasco of the Leipzig trials. No doubt this dismal upshot induced in some British officials a feeling of once bitten, twice shy, and helped to establish the atmosphere in which Churchill, Eden, and numerous other British officials concluded that international court trials of the Nazi leaders were all too likely to work more harm than good. It was plain, however, that this was a matter of deep interest to other countries, and in 1943, Churchill embarked on a program intended to bring the United States and Soviet governments around to the British view. The first move was the Moscow Declaration of November 1, 1943, based on a draft which Churchill had sent to Roosevelt and Stalin a few weeks earlier. The concluding paragraph, a classic example of the tail wagging the dog, did not explicitly state that the major criminals would be given no benefit of trial, but the phrase, "punished by a joint decision of the governments of the Allies," certainly lent itself to that interpretation. As a practical matter, this and other related issues could, from then on, only be decided by consultation among the Big Three. Opportunity for this came later that same month at their first meeting, which took place at Tehran at the end of November 1943. There was no agenda, but the purposes of the gathering were primarily military, and neither Churchill nor anyone else brought up the subject of war crimes at any of the plenary sessions. There was, however, a bizarre confrontation between Churchill and Stalin at a dinner hosted by the latter. The Soviet leader, for some reason, was in a mood to tease Churchill, primarily by accusing him of secret affection for the Germans. Matters came to a head when Stalin, in the course of a long speech, declared that 50,000 German general staff officers should be liquidated. Churchill took the remark seriously and angrily declared that neither he nor the British public would tolerate mass executions of military officers. The American diplomat Charles Bolin, who was serving as Roosevelt's interpreter and was the only Russian-speaking American present, thought that Stalin had made the remark in semi-jocular fashion, with a sardonic smile and wave of the hand, and meant it as a jibe at Churchill, rather than as an indication of his actual intentions. It was a very boozy evening, and though several writers have sought to draw important inferences from the episode, the recorded accounts by those present are in sharp conflict, and I think Bolin's conclusion is the most reliable. Meanwhile, in London, the Foreign Office and the Lord Chancellor were confronting the problem which inevitably rose from their proposed policy of summary disposition. Which German officials were so prominent in the pursuit of evil that they should be given the honor of execution without trial? It was the same difficulty that Antony, Lepidus, and Octavius had faced when they pricked a list of those to be killed after the murder of Julius Caesar. In May and June 1944, numerous British officials were preparing such lists, and whoever was pricked, there were always arguments that other names should be added. Hitler, Goering, Goebbels, Himmler, Ribbentrop, and Field Marshal Wilhelm Keitel, Hitler's military amanuensis, were all obvious choices, but there were several votes to add Admirals Karl Dönitz and Erich Raeder and a few generals. And Clement Attlee, then the deputy prime minister, wanted to add Franz von Papen, Schacht, and several of the bankers and industrialists who had financed Hitler's political rise. Later that summer, Churchill and Roosevelt decided to meet in Quebec in mid-September. And before leaving, Churchill informed the War Cabinet that he proposed to discuss personally with President Roosevelt the question of war criminals whose crimes had no geographical location. The Prime Minister went to Quebec armed with a memorandum from Lord Simon, which began with the pious hope that before the end of the war, these criminals would be disposed of by suicide or the action of the German people. Failing this happy outcome, and in accordance with a previously prepared list, the criminals would be executed on proof of identity and on the basis of a political decision. This came to be referred to in government circles as the Napoleonic precedent, since the little corporal had been exiled to St. Helena without trial and by political decision. At Quebec, the proposal sailed through smoothly, and on September 15, 1944, the president approved a memorandum stating that the President and the Prime Minister have agreed to put to Marshal Stalin Lord Simon's proposal for dealing with the major war criminals, and to concert with him a list of names. On the same day, the two leaders approved a memorandum embodying the so-called Morgenthau Plan to prevent the rearmament of Germany by closing down the Ruhr and Saar industries in order to make Germany into a country primarily agricultural and pastoral. Both Roosevelt and Churchill soon backed away from the Morgenthau Plan, but the Simon Plan for war criminals had a somewhat longer life. The following month, Churchill flew to Moscow to confer with Stalin. It was a difficult meeting because of disagreement over the future of Poland, and it was here that Churchill first encountered strong opposition to his war crimes proposals. On October 22, 1944, he informed Roosevelt, "Major war criminals, UJ, took an unexpectedly ultra-respectable line. There must be no executions without trial, otherwise the world would say we were afraid to try them. I pointed out the difficulties in international law, but he replied if there were no trials, there must be no death sentences, but only lifelong confinements. In face of this view, from this quarter I do not wish to press the memo I gave you, which you said you would have examined by the State Department. Kindly treated as withdrawn." Roosevelt, who by this time regretted his own approval of the Quebec Memoranda, replied noncommittally that Churchill's memo about Stalin's attitude was most interesting, and that these and other matters should be discussed at the forthcoming three-party meeting. At Yalta, Churchill brought up the matter near the end of the session on February 9, 1945. Referring to the final paragraph of the Moscow Declaration, he called it "an egg that I myself laid," and made his usual argument for shooting the leading Nazis once their identity had been established. Stalin then asked about Rudolf Hess, an inquiry plainly intended to needle Churchill, who replied rather lamely that events would catch up with Hess, adding that these men should be given a judicial trial, by which he probably meant that Hess and other war crimes suspects should get a trial, in contrast to the major criminals who would face summary execution. Churchill first proposed that the conferees should draw up a list of major criminals then and there, but later he withdrew that suggestion, declaring that he merely wanted an exchange of views and that nothing should be given out to the public. Stalin showed no desire for a serious interchange, and the president, who must have been a very tired man, indicated that he was not ready to consider the matter, so the discussion ended inconclusively. The published communique at Yalta merely stated that the question of major war criminals should be the subject of inquiry by the three foreign secretaries for report in due course after the close of the conference. The British summary execution plan died hard. Early in April 1945, Roosevelt sent his close advisor, Judge Samuel Rosenman, to discuss war crimes questions in London. En route, Rosenman met with Charles de Gaulle, then head of the Provisional Government of France, who stated that he favored trial rather than summary execution. But Lord Simon met Rosenman with the old arguments for summary execution. On April 12th, the War Cabinet, after much discussion, concluded that for the principal Nazi leaders, a full trial under judicial procedure was out of the question. That same day, President Roosevelt died. Rosenman at once returned to Washington, and further negotiations were put over to the United Nations Conference on International Organizations at San Francisco, where the foreign ministers' meeting called for in the Yalta communique finally took place. By then, the British were being overtaken by events. Soon after taking office, President Harry Truman made it clear that he opposed summary execution and supported the establishment of a tribunal to try the Nazi leaders. By the end of April, Germany was all but totally overrun by the Allied forces, and the Third Reich was disintegrating. On April 28, 1945, Benito Mussolini was shot and his body hung in public in Milan. On April 30th, Hitler committed suicide, and the ever-faithful Goebbels, with his family, followed his example the next day. Thus, the hopes that Lord Simon had voiced at Quebec were, in important part, fulfilled, for, of all the Nazi leaders, Hitler and Goebbels had been the two most likely to make an orderly trial difficult. On May 3rd, the War Cabinet capitulated and informed Eden, waiting impatiently in San Francisco, of his instructions. The position as regards the major war criminals has greatly changed since this matter was last considered. Many of these have already been killed, and the same fate may well overtake others before the fighting is over. The War Cabinet still see objections to having formal state trials for the most notorious war criminals whose crimes have no geographical location, but if our two major allies remain convinced that this is necessary, we are willing to accept their views on principle. There were better reasons than the deaths of Hitler and Goebbels and the imminent prospect of being outvoted for turning London around. No principled line could be drawn between those who would and those who would not be given opportunity to defend themselves before a court. Summary execution looked like a simple way out of troublesome problems, but it was out of tune with the times. Too many people believed that they had been wrongfully hurt by the leaders of the Third Reich and wanted a judgment to that effect. Furthermore, and although this may not have been felt as keenly in 1945 as it would have been a few years later, the spectacle of Joseph Stalin, who had sent uncounted thousands of his own countrymen to their deaths by his political decisions, sitting as one of a triumvirate to prick a list of Germans, would have made their decisions a target of mockery as long as memory endured. Section 4. Mankind is supposed to learn from experience, but individuals often learn quite different things from much the same experience. In 1944, the United States, like Britain, made a 180-degree turn from its 1919 war crimes policies, but in the opposite direction. In 1945, it was the United States that took the lead in planning and establishing an international tribunal and in expanding international penal law beyond the traditional limits of the laws of war. In Washington, despite the president's several public denunciations, no significant attention was given to the implementation of war crimes policies until the late summer of 1944, when the Wehrmacht was in desperate easterly retreat through France and Belgium. With an Allied victory apparently imminent, plans for the occupation of Germany became an immediate necessity. Simultaneously, the importance of war crimes as a part of such plans was underlined when Soviet troops advancing into Poland overran the Nazi extermination camp at Majdanek, near Lublin. At least seven different federal agencies had immediate or potential concern with war crimes questions: the Departments of State, War, Navy, Treasury, and Justice, the Office of Strategic Services, OSS, and of course, the White House itself. Initially, however, the War and Treasury departments were much the most vigorous participants, and the early discussions led, within a few weeks, to a sharp confrontation between their two chiefs, Secretary of War Henry L. Stimson and Secretary of the Treasury Henry Morgenthau, Jr. The Treasury Department was the citadel of the tough peace advocates, whose views were embodied in the Morgenthau Plan, known primarily for its proposal to abolish German heavy industry. But it also included a section on war crimes which closely resembled the British proposal, in that it envisaged the summary execution of those on a list of arch criminals by military firing squads, once their identity had been established. Secretary Stimson, on the other hand, opposed the draconian economic features of the Morgenthau Plan and believed that the United States should participate in an international tribunal for trial of the chief Nazi officials, who would be charged with offenses against the laws of the rules of war. These conflicting views were laid before the president in two meetings early in September 1944. Without reaching any decision, the president went off to the second Quebec meeting with Churchill. On September 13th, to the chagrin of both Stimson and Secretary of State Cordell Hull, Roosevelt asked Morgenthau to join him in Quebec, where, on September 15th, Roosevelt and Churchill initialed the Morgenthau Plan and agreed that Lord Simon's summary execution proposal be presented to Stalin. Morgenthau returned from Quebec the apparent victor, but his triumph was short-lived. News of Stimson's disagreement leaked to the press, and the public reaction to the most punitive features of the Morgenthau Plan was sharply adverse. Stimson sent a critical memorandum to the president, and at a meeting of the two on October 3, 1944, the president expressed great regret that he had initialed the Morgenthau document at Quebec and declared that Morgenthau had pulled a boner. The episode decisively weakened Treasury's influence on planning for the occupation of Germany, and, although the subject of war crimes appears not to have been discussed at the Roosevelt-Stimson meeting, the formulation of war crimes policy proceeded thereafter with no significant participation by Morgenthau or his staff. The president, chastened by the Quebec experience, told the State Department that he disliked making detailed plans for a country which we do not yet occupy, and for several months left Washington officialdom with no presidential guidance on war crimes policy formulation. In this situation, the War Department emerged as the dominant entity. The Navy Department, with little or no stake in the occupation of Germany, showed no interest in war crimes planning. Neither the Justice Department nor the OSS played a significant role until 1945. The State Department legal advisor, Judge Green Hackworth, participated in the planning process, but Secretary Hull was ill and out of favor at the White House. He resigned early in December 1944, but his successor, Edward R. Stettinius, was so inexperienced and tentative that his department's voice in decision-making was never strong. Stimson's ascendancy also foreclosed American support for the British summary execution plan. In his insistence that the Nazi leaders stand trial, the secretary had the strong support of both the Army Chief of Staff, General George C. Marshall, and the Army's principal lawyer, Judge Advocate General Myron C. Kramer. But as the dust of the Stimson-Morgenthau dispute settled, nothing else about the scope or nature of the trial or trials had been determined. Within the War Department, the unit which, by mission and tradition, would be primarily responsible for war crimes planning was the office of the Judge Advocate General, JAG. And so it was at the outset. In August, JAG submitted a proposed directive to Army commanders in the field for the apprehension of enemy individuals suspected of violations of the laws and customs of war, a thoroughly conventional approach to the matter. The source of the proposals, which eventually blossomed into the Nuremberg ideas, was found elsewhere in the War Department, and first appeared in a memorandum on September 15, 1944, authored by Colonel Murray Bernays, a member of the Personnel Branch G1 of the Army General Staff. Bernays, in peacetime a successful New York lawyer, had been concerned with the treatment of American prisoners of war in Germany and was aware of the extensive atrocities against Russian prisoners and others committed by members of Nazi organizations, such as the SS. He also knew of the demands, then emanating from the American Jewish Conference and the War Refugee Board, for the punishment of Nazi crimes against German Jews during the pre-war years, which the State Department regarded as outside the scope of the laws of war. There were many thousands of war criminals who should be tried for crimes committed all over Europe, Bernays wrote, and pointed out the numerous difficulties which would be confronted in obtaining evidence to convict so many individuals. His memorandum of September 15th proposed methods for resolving these two problems, to wit, finding a legal basis for punishing the pre-war German crimes and developing a procedure for dealing with the hundreds of thousands of members of the SS and other Nazi organizations implicated in German atrocities. To meet the first difficulty, Bernays resorted to the Anglo-American law of criminal conspiracy, proposing that the Nazi organizations and their leading members be charged before an international court not merely with atrocious violations of the laws of war, but with conspiring, presumably from the beginning of the Nazi period in 1933 or earlier, to commit such violations. In Anglo-American law, criminal conspiracy consists of an agreement by two or more persons to engage in unlawful conduct. Bernays reasoned, therefore, that if members of the Nazi organizations had agreed among themselves prior to the war to commit violations of the laws of war when war came, their preparatory conduct before the war would be punishable as a part of the conspiracy to commit the wartime atrocities. The second problem, how to cope with defendants numbered in six or seven figures, a ghoulish embarras de richesse, Bernays proposed to deal with by indicting the Nazi organizations themselves and providing that once such an organization was convicted on the conspiracy charge, all its members might thereafter likewise be found guilty on proof of membership alone. The severity of punishment for individual members would be governed by evidence of the extent to which they were involved in or knew of the organization's criminal activities. There were weighty objections to both of these proposals. The Anglo-American concept of conspiracy was not part of European legal systems and arguably not an element of the internationally recognized laws of war. The proposal that the leading members of Nazi organizations be given a judicial trial, while rank-and-file members of convicted Nazi organizations would be found guilty on mere proof of membership, appeared to turn upside down the British plan to punish the major war criminals by political decision and try the lesser fry before national war crimes tribunals. However, the problems Bernays had tackled were very real, and no one was coming up with better solutions. His plan picked up support as well as encountering opposition when it was scrutinized in other branches of the War Department. Secretary Stimson had delegated to the Assistant Secretary of War, John J. McCloy, responsibility for developing a war crimes program. And both McCloy and his assistant executive officer, Colonel Ami Cutter, reacted favorably enough so that, on October 24th, Bernays was given opportunity to present his plan at a general conference on war crimes in Stimson's office. The secretary was greatly impressed and especially enthusiastic about the conspiracy concept. No formal approval was given to the Bernays plan, but Stimson promptly passed it on as worthy of complete investigation to the State and Navy Departments, and on November 21st, meeting with the President, he outlined the conspiracy approach, with the result, as described in Stimson's diary, that Roosevelt gave his very frank approval when I said that conspiracy with representatives of all classes of actors brought in from top to bottom would be the best way to try it and would give us a record and also a trial which would certainly persuade any onlooker of the evil of the Nazi system. A week after this meeting, a new wellspring of war crimes ideas surfaced in the person of Colonel William C. Chandler, the Deputy Director of Military Government, and in peacetime a law partner, friend, and neighbor of Stimson's. Prior to his War Department appointment, Colonel Chandler had been Chief Legal Officer of the Allied Military Government in Italy. and his period of service included the 7 weeks during which Mussolini was interned by the Badoglio government of Italy. This situation had led Chandler, then in Palermo, to ponder a war crimes trial of Mussolini, and he and Colonel Robert O. Gorman drew up an indictment which included a charge of engaging in unlawful warfare against peaceful nations. Mussolini's escape from Italy to Germany rendered the project academic, but in late November 1944, Chandler, back in the Pentagon, and noting that the Bernays plan did not include any charge based on the illegality of Germany's resort to war, revived the ideas he had developed in Italy and embodied them in a memorandum which he submitted directly to Stimson. Stimson thought Chandler's thesis a little in advance of the progress of international thought, and in fact, the legal theory on which Chandler based his conclusion was never widely accepted. But the secretary was highly sympathetic to Chandler's wish to include a charge based on the illegality of aggressive war. And, as time went on, Stimson became increasingly convinced of the great moral and political importance of securing a judicial decision that launching an aggressive war was criminal under international law. Stimson, nonetheless, does not appear to have ever laid such a recommendation before the president, and 1944 came to its end with the lawyers in the several departments still sunk in controversy over all these questions. However, on January 3, 1945, President Roosevelt, for the first and last time, gave direct, though informal and unpublished, instructions to his subordinates on the subject of war crimes. In a memorandum addressed to Secretary of State Stettinius, he wrote, "Please send me a brief report on the state of the proceedings before the War Crimes Commission, and particularly the attitude of the U.S. representative on offenses to be brought against Hitler and the chief Nazi war criminals. The charges should include an indictment for waging aggressive war in violation of the Kellogg Pact. Perhaps these and other charges might be joined in a conspiracy indictment." The occasion for the first sentence is plain, for the U.S. representative was Roosevelt's friend, Herbert Pell, who was continually at loggerheads with the State Department and was even then requesting an audience with the president. In the third sentence, the reference to a conspiracy indictment is in line with Roosevelt's approval of Stimson's recommendations at their meeting on November 21, 1944. But what explains the mandate in the second sentence? There is no sure answer. One writer has plausibly inferred that it was suggested to the president by his special counsel, speechwriter, and valued advisor, Judge Samuel Rosenman, whom the president had recently designated to iron out the department's conflicting views on war crimes policy. But there is a more likely explanation. Colonel Chandler had summarized his views in a half-page memorandum which, probably sometime in December 1944, he sent directly to the president via Lieutenant Colonel John Boedeker, Chandler's army colleague and Roosevelt's son-in-law. The president's reference to the Kellogg Pact, which was the cornerstone of Chandler's thesis, strongly suggests that it was the half-page Chandler memorandum that triggered the president's endorsement of the aggressive war criminality concept. The president was soon to depart for the Yalta Conference. Rosenman was under pressure to provide him with a position paper and proved adept at negotiating a compromise. Only the Stimson group had a well-developed position, and the upshot of the negotiations was a document in which the Bernays contributions were included. It was delivered to the president on January 22nd in the form of a memorandum initialed by the Secretaries of State and War and the Attorney General, Francis Biddle. An international tribunal was to be established to try both the highest-ranking German leaders and the Nazi groups and organizations through which they had acted. These defendants would be charged with both the commission of crimes and conspiracy to commit them, and the crimes would comprise pre-war atrocities against their own German nationals, the waging of an illegal war of aggression, and violations of the laws of war. After the international trial, and assuming that the tribunal had found guilty one or more of the Nazi organizations, individual members of each such organization would be brought before occupation courts, where the only necessary proof of guilt of any particular defendant would be his membership, while the punishment would be made appropriate to the facts of his particular case. public pressure for a decision was mounting fast. In December 1944, during the Battle of the Bulge, news of the slaughter of some 70 American prisoners at Malmedy in Belgium by troops of an SS tank regiment sent a wave of indignation throughout the country and convinced the doubters that stories of SS atrocities were no figments of propaganda. 4 months later, as British and American troops overran Western Germany, the horrors of the concentration camps, Belsen, Dachau, Buchenwald, were exposed. There was growing unrest in Congress at the lack of authoritative information about the government's war crimes plans. The Yalta communique had called for a report from the foreign ministers of the Big Three, Eden, Vyacheslav Molotov, and Stettinius, who were just then gathering at the San Francisco Conference for consideration and adoption of the United Nations Charter. War crimes were not on the agenda, but it was decided to seize the opportunity of San Francisco to bring about a meeting at which the War Department plan would be accepted, at least as a basis for discussion. In preparation for such a meeting, the chief legal craftsman of the Stimson Group spent many hours reviewing and revising the basic memorandum and proposed executive agreement to make them more suitable for foreign scrutiny and approval. While this was going on, President Truman, by an executive order published May 2, 1945, appointed Robert H. Jackson, Associate Justice of the Supreme Court, as representative of the United States and Chief of Counsel in preparing and prosecuting charges of atrocities and war crimes against such of the leaders of the European Axis powers as the United States may agree with any of the United Nations to bring to trial before an international military tribunal. It appears that the major impetus for creating such an office and selecting Jackson to fill it came from the Stimson Group. Ordinarily, the president would have consulted the attorney general, but Truman and Biddle were not then on good terms. On April 22nd, McCloy sent Rosenman a memorandum declaring that there was imperative need of having counsel designated immediately to prepare the United States side of the main war criminals' cases. There followed a list of 8 names in alphabetical order, including Supreme Court Justices Owen Roberts, 70 years old and ready to retire, and Robert H. Jackson, Sidney Alderman, lawyer for the Southern Railway, John Harlan, and Theodore Kiendel, the last two litigating partners in large New York firms. Perhaps as a bow to seniority, McCloy described Roberts as probably our first selection. But in fact, McCloy, Chandler, Robert Patterson, Undersecretary of War and a former federal judge, and Rosenman were all solidly behind Jackson, whom they had known during the Roosevelt administration as Solicitor General, Attorney General, and Supreme Court Justice. Shortly before his appointment was announced, Jackson reviewed the documents that had been prepared for San Francisco and suggested some revisions. In particular, he thought the memorandum was too impassioned and gives the impression that it is setting up a court organized to convict. But he readily accepted the structure and content of the War Department plan and left it to the Rosenman-McCloy group to sell it at San Francisco. On May 3, 1945, when the Big Three foreign ministers met, Stettinius presided, but Rosenman presented the American plan. Stettinius next called for a decision on the question of French participation. There were no objections, but the French foreign minister, Georges Bidault, was not immediately available, so it was agreed that Stettinius would bring him up to date and invite his participation. Eden then announced that his government accepted the decision to bring the major criminals before a tribunal and would join in the trial. Molotov declared himself unable to comment on such important matters on short notice. The American proposals were then remitted to the legal advisors for further consideration, and during the next 2 weeks, Rosenman and his associates met with their British, French, and Soviet opposite members and discussed a wide variety of questions and proposed amendments. But the other governments never authorized their delegations to accept the American proposals, so once again, most of the major policy decisions were put off to another day. Section 5. So ended the first phase of the Nuremberg Undertaking, during which the basic concepts of trials were developed. the ideas of trying defeated leaders before an international tribunal and of extending international criminal law to both domestic atrocities against religious and racial groups and the launching of aggressive war had all been broached, albeit unsuccessfully, at Versailles in 1919. Both the concepts of conspiracy and of organizational guilt were new to international penal law, though not to Anglo-American domestic law. The initial pressure for post-war trials came from the peoples of the German-occupied nations, but the assemblage of all these concepts in a single trial package was the work of a handful of American lawyers, all but Cutter, who was from Boston, from New York City. Some of them, Stimson, McCloy, were what today we would call moderate Republicans. Several, Rosenman, Chandler, Herbert Wexler, were Democrats. Elitist and generally accustomed to personal prosperity, all had strong feelings of noblesse oblige. What moved these men to push out of their way the JAG, the usual repository of war crimes matters, and steer their government into these paths, most of them controversial, and some of them novel? Bernays, originator of two of the most original proposals, appears to have been motivated by the same desires as those of the victims of German occupation. He wanted to visit condign retribution by law on the multitude of Germans who shared complicity in the atrocities. His invocation of organizational responsibility did not broaden the concept of war crimes, but was a juridical device to eliminate the need to prove complicity of the individual members of the organizations, primarily the SS, which were responsible for many, if not most, of the crimes, by making membership itself sufficient proof of guilt. There were a few precedents in Anglo-American domestic law for attaching individual guilt to organizational membership, including the then recently enacted Smith Act, 1940, in which Congress made it a felony to be a member of any organization which advocated overthrow of the United States government by the use of force and violence. But the Smith Act had been passed over the president's veto and was anathema to civil libertarians. The men of the Stimson Group were, in varying degrees, sensitive to the traditional rights of the accused and the dangers of guilt by association. Why did they accept a procedure which so clearly threatened those safeguards? No doubt it is difficult for many of today's listeners to grasp the utter hatred of the SS which its actions had spread throughout the Western world, especially during the last 2 years of the war, when there was incontrovertible proof of the wholesale massacre of Jews, the horrors of the concentration camps, and the killings of prisoners of war, as at Malmedy. I remember attending a party in Washington early in 1945 during a brief home leave, at which the nearly unanimous view of the guests, most libertarian New Dealers, was that all members of the SS should be put to death. And I was attacked as soft on Germany for expressing a contrary opinion. With such attitudes afloat, it is hardly surprising that at the Treasury, Morgenthau and his staff were proposing the permanent exile of all SS members and their families. Bernays' organizational guilt plan, insofar as it contemplated a hearing at which the penalty for membership would be based on the individual's degree of complicity, was, obviously, far less arbitrary or draconian. The other members of the Stimson Group no doubt shared the prevailing wish for retribution. However, Colonel Chandler's memorandum on the aggressive war concept inspired a different and greater concern, which, for Stimson, became the dominant feature of the Nuremberg process. With the judgment at Nuremberg, he wrote in 1947, we at last reach to the very core of international strife, and we set a penalty not merely for war crimes, but for the very act of war itself, except in self-defense. In short, it was war and not its methods that was the central moral problem. It was a matter of chance that the United Nations Charter and the first international consensus on war crimes were contemporaneously achieved at San Francisco. But the coincidence is meaningful. As Justice Jackson's son, William E. Jackson, later wrote, it is perhaps not commonly apprehended that the principles of Nuremberg go hand in hand with the organization of the United Nations as the twin foundations of an international society ordered by law. Essentially, in the minds of Stimson and his colleagues, their prime purpose was to bring the weight of law and criminal sanctions to bear in support of the peaceful and humanitarian principles that the United Nations was to promote by consultation and collective action. Chapter 3. Justice Jackson takes over. After the Rosenman-McCloy delegation returned from San Francisco, full leadership of the Nuremberg venture passed to Jackson. Henceforth, the war, soon to be renamed defense, and state departments would only occasionally be involved in war crimes decision-making, though they continued to furnish basic support. Robert H. Jackson was not one of the legal Brahmins typical of the Stimson group. He had a rural upbringing in western New York State, did not attend college, and his higher education consisted of 1 year at Albany Law School. He was probably the last nationally prominent lawyer to gain admission to the bar by serving an apprenticeship rather than by a law school degree. Despite these academic shortcomings, Jackson developed, in the small city of Jamestown, a successful regional law practice, and, more important for present purposes, a superb command of the English language. Jackson's courtroom success and Democratic Party preference brought him to the attention of New York State's major politicians, Franklin Roosevelt, Herbert Lehman, Henry Morgenthau, and in 1934, he was appointed General Counsel of the Bureau of Internal Revenue. Thereafter, promotions came fast. Assistant Attorney General in 1936, Solicitor General in 1938, Attorney General in January 1940, Associate Justice of the United States Supreme Court in July 1941. Jackson's forensic talents were especially admired during his service as Solicitor General, but it was as Attorney General that he first encountered situations which touched closely on one of the major issues he would later confront in connection with Nuremberg. His tenure as Attorney General comprised most of the uneasy period between the outbreak of war in Europe in September 1939 and the Japanese attack at Pearl Harbor in December 1941, which threw America into the war. The country as a whole strongly favored the Allies against Nazi Germany, but there was strong sentiment for non-involvement and neutrality, even at the risk of defeat for the Allies. In 1940, Roosevelt won re-election to a third term, promising the electorate that their boys would not be sent to foreign wars. But after the fall of France, with Britain under heavy attack by the Luftwaffe and facing possible invasion, Roosevelt's own views and those of many of his countrymen led to measures in support of Britain which raised grave issues under the international law of neutrality. Early in 1941, Congress passed the Lend-Lease Act, which Jackson, as Attorney General, interpreted as explicitly adopting the policy that defense of certain countries now at war, including Great Britain, is vital to our own defense, and that the furnishing of aid to such countries is essential to the security of the United States. Such measures triggered Jackson's interest in the international law of war, a subject which he publicly addressed in March 1941 in a speech to the Inter-American Bar Association at Havana. Drawing on the old doctrine of just and unjust wars, Jackson flatly rejected the view that all wars are legal and that neutrals invariably owe a duty of impartiality as between one belligerent and another. He declared that aggressive wars are civil wars against the international community, and, invoking the Kellogg-Briand Pact, accused the Axis powers of shamefully violating their obligations under it. Their guilt, he said, fully justified neutrals in giving aid to the victims of aggression. Once on the bench, Jackson spoke no further on such matters until April 13, 1945, the day after Roosevelt's death, when he addressed the American Society of International Law on the topic, The Rule of Law Among Nations. For the first time, Jackson gave public evidence of his thinking on war crimes. I have no purpose to enter into any controversy as to what shall be done with war criminals, either high or humble. If it is considered good policy for the future peace of the world, if it is believed that the example will outweigh the tendency to create among their own countrymen a myth of martyrdom, then let them be executed. But in that case, let the decision to execute them be made as a military or political decision. Of course, if good faith trials are sought, that is another matter. I am not troubled, as some seem to be, over problems of jurisdiction of war criminals, or of finding existing and recognized law by which standards of guilt may be determined. But all experience teaches that there are certain things you cannot do under the guise of judicial trial. Courts try cases, but cases also try courts. You must put no man on trial before anything that is called a court under the forms of judicial proceedings if you are not willing to see him freed, if not proven guilty. Thus, when Samuel Rosenman entered Justice Jackson's office on April 26, 1945, to convey President Truman's wish to appoint Jackson as his country's representative and chief counsel for war crimes, he was talking to a man who already had a considerable public record on the subject and who would be a strong advocate of a charge based on the illegality of aggressive war. Furthermore, the passage just quoted was a clarion call for just trials. There should be no drumhead court-martial, no Moscow-type show trial, no foregone conclusions. There should be no trials at all unless prosecutors and judges alike were agreed that defendants should be acquitted if the law and facts did not support their conviction. Jackson was barely 2 days into his new assignment when that commitment was put to the test. With victory in hand, the question of war reparations from Germany arose, and an inter-allied reparations commission was established. In Washington, an interdepartmental informal policy committee on Germany drafted instructions for the American representative on the Reparations Committee, Edwin W. Pauley, a California corporate executive in the oil business and a member of the Democratic National Committee, whom Roosevelt and later Truman often used as a special presidential representative on foreign economic matters. One section of these instructions dealt with compulsory labor service as an element of reparations, and provided that such service could be required from war criminals and individuals definitely determined by appropriate process to be members of the Gestapo, the SS, the Sicherheitsdienst, leaders of the SA, or leading collaborators, supporters of, and participants in the Nazi Party or administration. This and other parts of the instructions had been drafted by officials in the Treasury Department. When this document was reviewed at the War Department, Colonel Chandler pointed out to Bernays that it, in effect, inflicted penal servitude on members of the very organizations which, under the American War Crimes Plan, were to have their guilt determined by an international tribunal. During the evening of May 3rd, Bernays telephoned this information to Jackson, who at once concluded that such a provision would prejudge the criminality of these organizations and their members and make it farcical to conduct trials on that issue. Armed with a memorandum urging that liability for penal servitude be limited to convicted war criminals, on May 12th, Jackson met with Pauley. Also present were Averill Harriman, then ambassador to the Soviet Union, Rosenman, and Isidore Lubon, chief of the Bureau of Labor Statistics, one of the draftsmen of the proposal. When Lubon disclosed that Russia wanted a working force of 5 million to repair her war-devastated areas, Jackson was shocked at the idea of transporting to Russia masses of people, and Harriman predicted that they would be subjected to atrocious living conditions. After Jackson had stated flatly that he could not go ahead with pretended trials if this provision were agreed upon, the conferees decided that it would have to be modified. On the morning of May 15th, Jackson took the matter to Truman, who approved the justice's stance on the matter. Thus, Jackson was in a strong position when, on May 18th, there was a showdown conference in Morgenthau's office, with over 20 participants representing the interested agencies. There were some hot words, but by this time Morgenthau had little support except from his own staff, and in the end, even he felt constrained to vote for an amendment in line with Jackson's viewpoint. Morgenthau resigned shortly thereafter. Jackson's victory was not without cost. A few days later, the widely read Washington columnist Drew Pearson published extracts from Jackson's memorandum to Pauley, which had been classified top secret, together with an attack on him for being soft on Germany. Plainly, Jackson's job was going to have its rough side. Section 2. Jackson's first task was to assemble a staff, and of the Stimson group, only Colonel Bernays was available. For fiscal reasons, Jackson wished to rely primarily on personnel loaned to him by other federal agencies, but his first selection was from outside the government, and was further surprising in that it was a man with whom he had no personal acquaintance. On May 3rd, Jackson telephoned Sidney Alderman, whose arguments before the Supreme Court Jackson had greatly admired. He asked Alderman to come aboard as his first assistant, an invitation which was promptly accepted. At about the same time, Jackson secured from the Justice Department the services of Assistant Attorney General Francis M. Shea, with whom he had had a close personal and professional relation since the early New Deal days. These two men were to be Jackson's principal associates during the next 5 or 6 months. Broader in import, however, was the relation Jackson soon established with Major General William J. Donovan and the organization which he headed, the Office of Strategic Services. As a battalion and regimental National Guard commander in World War I, from which he emerged with the sobriquet Wild Bill, Donovan was awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor and many other decorations. Thereafter, he held several federal offices and established a highly successful law practice. In 1941, Roosevelt appointed him Coordinator of Information and a year later Director of the OSS, responsible to the Joint Chiefs of Staff. Donovan had been interested in war crimes at least since 1943, and in 1944 he committed his agency to cooperate with the War Crimes Division of JAG. In March 1945, after discussing with the President's close advisor Harry Hopkins, Donovan sent a memorandum to the President proposing that the German people themselves should undertake to bring to trial and punish certain war criminals under pre-1933 German laws. Although there was a certain volatility in Donovan's thinking on the subject, it nevertheless is clear that his interest was genuine, for early in April 1945, he directed the OSS General Counsel, Lieutenant James Donovan, to get us a top-flight staff on war crimes, which were something on which we must be prepared at once. And as soon as Jackson's appointment was announced, Donovan coupled his letter of congratulations with the information that his agency had done certain work in the war crimes field and would cooperate with you in any manner which you deem desirable. Sorely pressed for staff and general logistical support, Jackson jumped at the offer and asked for all the assistance that could be given. Soon, General Donovan was being referred to as Jackson's first deputy. The hierarchical relation between the general on the one hand and Alderman and Shea on the other was never clarified. James Donovan made an excellent impression on Jackson and joined the inner circle of his advisors. On June 7, 1945, the relation was formalized by a letter from Jackson to General Donovan. It was a relationship which greatly benefited the Nuremberg project in terms of staff and equipment, but the personal ties between Jackson and Donovan were never strong, and they gave way shortly before the trials began. Other high-level appointments to Jackson's staff included Colonel John Harlan Amon, a well-known New York lawyer who since 1942 had been in the Inspector General's branch of the Army, Gordon Dean, who had been press officer at the Department of Justice to handle press relations, and Jackson's son William, who had graduated from law school in 1944 and, commissioned a naval ensign, had been serving in the Bureau of Ships. Bernays was appointed as the staff's executive officer. Jackson had apparently undertaken his task under the impression that the War Department, and perhaps other government agencies, would have evidence connecting the Nazi leaders with the crimes to be charged. But on May 7th, and again 10 days later, he had rude awakenings to the truth, which was that Washington was little better off than the UNWCC in this respect. James Donovan first disclosed this situation to the justice, and on May 17th, Amon reported that JAG had no cases ready for trial and virtually nothing implicating the major defendants. On May 21st, General John Ware of JAG confessed that even with respect to the Malmedy massacre, he had no way of identifying the guilty individuals. They had all been in tanks, and in his opinion, Malmedy was washed out as a war crimes case. JAG had but one important piece of evidence, the text of Hitler's commando order of October 18, 1942, directing the execution of all enemy commando troops, even if captured in full uniform. This was, of course, a flagrant violation of the Hague Conventions. On May 22nd, rightly concluding that neither his evidentiary nor his diplomatic aims could be furthered in Washington, Jackson, with Amon, flew to Paris to see what progress could be made on that side of the Atlantic. Section 3. Accordingly, Justice Jackson was across the ocean on May 24th when, still undecided about my own immediate future, I first visited his staff's offices in the Pentagon building. I met Sidney Alderman, a gentle-mannered southerner who was later to be my housemate in Nuremberg, and then had lunch with Frank Shea, a close friend under whom I had worked both at the Agricultural Adjustment Administration in 1934 and at the Department of Justice in 1939. By the next day, I had decided to cast my lot with the Jackson team and reported for duty to Colonel Bernays, the executive officer. Although my relations with him were always cordial, I never came to know him well because he soon went to London, and shortly after I returned to England, he resigned, dissatisfied and ailing, and resumed his New York law practice. He was a slender, sallow-complexioned man with white hair and cavernous eyes, and never looked to me like a well man. But his resignation was motivated in large part by disappointment over his decline in the prosecution hierarchy. His initial contributions to the Nuremberg enterprise were unique and substantial, but his talents were conceptual rather than operational, and after the general shape of the project was established, he was edged out of leadership by stronger and more versatile men. I was assigned a desk and was pleased to find as my office neighbor Lieutenant Colonel Benjamin Kaplan, a contemporary whom I knew by reputation as an exceptionally able New York lawyer. In later years, he was a professor at Harvard Law School and then a judge of the Supreme Judicial Court of Massachusetts. During the war, he had been working in military procurement under John J. McCloy, Robert Patterson, and General Lucius Clay, my future boss. Kaplan and I soon agreed that the staff was stuck on dead center. Jackson, as well as General Donovan and Colonel Ammon, were in Europe. Alderman and Shea were almost as new to the subject matter as we were. Bernays did not seem to know what to do with the new recruits. But it soon became apparent that there was a deeper cause of this malaise. Our task was to prepare to prosecute the leading Nazis on the criminal charges described in the draft executive agreement presented at the San Francisco conference. The first question a prosecuting attorney asks in such a situation is, "Where's the evidence?" The blunt fact was that, despite what everybody knew about the Nazi leaders, virtually no judicially admissible evidence was at hand. Unless it could be found, all the care put into drafting agreements and organization plans would be wasted effort. The only available veterans of past war crimes activities were Bernays and James Donovan. In mid-May, they had drafted a planning memorandum and a memorandum on trial preparation, and these documents had been approved by Jackson shortly before he went to Europe. The planning memorandum described, in a discursive way, the proposed charges against the defendants, characterizing their common plan as aimed at complete domination of Europe and eventually of the world, and listed some 25 ingredients of the proof necessary to prove the charges. The trial preparation memo gave the task of providing the necessary evidence to the JAG for aggressive war and violations of the laws of war, and to the OSS for other atrocities and the common plan. The responsibilities thus imposed were formidable and fundamental, and I was very doubtful that either agency could fulfill them. Indeed, though I did not know it at the time, Jackson had already been disabused of the notion that the JAG would be an important source of evidence, and my own visits to the JAG offices late in May led me to the same conclusion. As for the OSS, James Donovan had previously assured Bernays that his agency had done a great deal of work and assembled much material on its assigned subjects. but his progress report on May 30th did not encourage me to believe that the OSS would be much more productive of real evidence than the JAG. In fact, the OSS staff included a number of able and learned experts on the Third Reich, but most of what they had to offer, however valuable as background information, was neither documentary nor testimonial evidence suitable for court use. I soon concluded that Washington was not the right place for Jackson's headquarters and that he should move it to Europe. My wartime duties had not involved captured documents or prisoner interrogation, but I had been working in the world of military intelligence and knew where and by whom those things were handled. I also knew that with the occupation of Western Germany, a number of Allied target teams, both military and civilian, had gone in behind the frontline troops to collar and sequester all high-ranking Germans and other informed persons for interrogation, to locate and collect official files and other documentary caches of military or other significance, and to generally sniff out and secure anything and everything of use for governmental purposes. These teams, I was sure, would be the prime source of the evidence we needed. So thinking, I decided that the best use I could make of my time would be to put my information and thoughts on evidence gathering into a memorandum, which would also include some general comments on the situation and problems confronting the Jackson staff. I entitled it, An Approach to the Preparation of the Prosecution of Axis Criminality, and submitted it to Alderman on June 2nd. The memorandum reveals my initial and, to a great extent, my continuing perception of the nature and purpose of the prosecution, and, deservedly or not, it made a considerable impression on Jackson, and thus brought me a place among his principal associates. As I saw it, the two most important things to be accomplished by the trials were to give meaning to the war against Germany, to validate the casualties we have suffered and the destruction and casualties we have caused, to make the war meaningful and valid for the people of the Allied nations and, it is not beyond hope, for at least some people of the Axis nations, to establish and maintain harmonious relations with the other United Nations in the presentation and successful prosecution of the case. Incalculable harm can be done if the trial bogs down as the result of disagreement among the United Nations, or if the several nations proceed separately and in a spirit critical of each other. In view of the criminal charges listed in the draft executive agreement, I had of course been hearing much discussion of the question of whether the launching of aggressive war could legitimately be treated as an international law crime. I wrote, This phase of the case is based on the assumption that it is or will be declared a punishable offense to plan and launch and lose an aggressive war, particularly if treaties are thereby violated. Although the phrase illegal launching is a law idea, the thing we want to accomplish is not a legal thing, but a political thing. Its accomplishment depends on persuading the several participating nations to take the political step of committing themselves to this doctrine. The ex post facto problem, I wrote, was not a bothersome question if we keep in mind that this is a political decision to declare and apply a principle of international law. Furthermore, only the most incorrigible legalists can pretend to be shocked by the conclusion that the perpetrator of an aggressive war acts at peril of being punished for his perpetration, even if no tribunal has ever previously decided that perpetration of an aggressive war is a crime. And, in any event, the ex post facto question is rendered much easier by the fact of treaty violation. A man who violates a treaty must act at peril of being punished by the offended parties employing self-help. What defenses could the Nazi leaders raise against the aggressive war charge? Much of the British opposition to trying these men had arisen from fear that they would use the courtroom as a forum for accusing the British and French of having grievously injured Germany after World War I, by the terms of the Versailles Treaty, the French occupation of the Ruhr in 1923, the failures of the victorious powers to disarm, and other political and economic sins. I was no historian, but I remembered something of the successful attacks against the Versailles Treaty's imposition of war guilt on Germany and her allies, which had been brought by revisionist historians such as Sidney B. Fay and Harry Elmer Barnes. It appeared to me that such issues should be ruled irrelevant, on the familiar legal principle that a destitute man who steals groceries is a thief, even though his purpose is to feed his starving children. The paragraph that I wrote on this problem was the one which, as Jackson told me, was most helpful to his own thinking. It is important that the trial not become an inquiry into the causes of the war. It cannot be established that Hitlerism was the sole cause of the war, and there should be no effort to do this. Nor, I believe, should there be any effort or time spent on apportioning out responsibility for causing the war among the many nations and individuals concerned. The question of causation is important and will be discussed for many years, but it has no place in this trial, which must rather stick rigorously to the doctrine that planning and launching an aggressive war is illegal, whatever may be the factors that caused the defendants to plan and to launch. Contributing causes may be pleaded by the defendants before the bar of history, but not before the tribunal. Following these general observations, the balance of the memorandum was devoted to evidence gathering, including a description of the way in which captured documents were being handled by our occupying forces, and a suggestion of particular ways in which the British could be of great help. In conclusion, I wrote, "In my views as to A. division of business with the other participating nations, and B. location of most of the vitally important evidence in Europe, are correct, it would appear that the bulk of the immediate staff should move to Europe, as soon as possible, leaving a few members behind for the time being to coordinate the work in progress at OSS, WCO, War Crimes Office, and elsewhere." Section 4. Meanwhile, Jackson had spent a busy week in Europe, visiting Paris, the American military headquarters in Frankfurt am Main and Wiesbaden, and London. He had luckily encountered the French officials Georges Bidault and Georges Bonnet on the plane to Paris, which enabled him to explain his plans. In Paris, he met with General Eisenhower, who agreed that there ought to be a trial, but hoped it would not take too long. The judge advocate for the European theater, General Edward C. Betts, gave Jackson the first of several lectures he would be receiving on the bad behavior of the Russians, which the justice found somewhat frightening and made him apprehensive about the turnover of any prisoners to the Russians. Leaving Amman in Paris to commence interrogation and document searching, Jackson stopped next at Eisenhower's headquarters in Frankfurt, where he conferred with the chief of staff, General Walter Bedell Smith, who proved somewhat skeptical of Jackson's undertaking. Smith, who less than a year later was appointed ambassador to the Soviet Union, told Jackson that the Russians were speedily resolving the war crimes problem by summary executions. At the JAG forward base in Wiesbaden, Lieutenant Colonel Charles Micklewaite had a large number of cases against Germans who had killed or injured American aviators shot down in Germany, but nothing involving the Nazi leaders. On returning to Paris, Jackson held a press conference and obtained valuable evidentiary material, including the diary kept by Galeazzo Ciano, Mussolini's son-in-law and foreign minister, from Alan Dulles, who had served the OSS brilliantly in Switzerland. In London, Jackson joined forces with General Donovan and William D. Whitney, a prominent New York lawyer who had also been admitted to the English bar and had extensive British connections. On May 29, 1945, the three Americans met with the British Attorney General, Sir David Maxwell Fife, whose appointment as Jackson's opposite number was announced that day, and other officials representing the Lord Chancellor, the Foreign Office, and the Treasury. This body, subsequently christened the British War Crimes Executive, BWCE, became the British government's control group for war crimes policies. The discussion was disorganized and on all sides reflected confusion about the problems and prospects. All seemed to expect that there would be guilty pleas and recorded their agreement that the opening trials should be of those, if any, who were weak enough to plead guilty. The conferees also considered whether the convicted Nazis might be subjected to corporal punishment. Upon Jackson's remonstrance that this would never be tolerated by the U.S., the idea was dropped. More important, the British accepted the plan to seek declaratory judgments against the Nazi organizations, and it was agreed that the French and Russians should be invited to a four-power meeting in London for negotiations looking to a protocol along the lines of the San Francisco proposals. The following day, Jackson and General Donovan visited Fedor Gusev, the Soviet ambassador to Britain. Perhaps as a result of General Betz's indoctrination, Jackson took a rather blunt posture, telling Gusev that the United States would proceed with the trial whether or not the Soviet Union chose to cooperate. On May 31st, Jackson returned to Washington. The following day, he saw the president, and it was agreed that there should be a written report for immediate publication. The report, which was released on June 7, 1945, met with wide and generally favorable attention. After describing his activities during the month since his appointment, Jackson pointed to the inescapable responsibility which attached to his country's custody of many of the Nazi leaders. What shall we do with them? We could, of course, set them at large without a hearing, but it has cost unmeasured thousands of American lives to beat and bind these men. To free them without a trial would mock the dead and make cynics of the living. On the other hand, we could execute or otherwise punish them without a hearing, but undiscriminating executions or punishments without definite findings of guilt, fairly arrived at, would violate pledges repeatedly given and would not set easily on the American conscience or be remembered by our children with pride. The only other course is to determine the innocence or guilt of the accused after a hearing as dispassionate as the times and horrors we deal with will permit, and upon a record that will leave our reasons and motives clear. The prosecution's purpose would be to provide a well-documented history of what we are convinced was a grand, concerted pattern to incite and coerce the aggressions and barbarities which have shocked the world. Unless we write the record of this moment with clarity and precision, we cannot blame the future if in days of peace it finds incredible the accusatory generalities uttered during the war. We must establish incredible events by credible evidence. The defendants would comprise a large number of individuals and officials who were in authority in the government, in the military establishment, including the general staff, and in the financial, industrial, and economic life of Germany, who, by all civilized standards, are provable to be common criminals. The charges against them would be A. Atrocities and offenses against persons or property constituting violations of international law, including the laws, rules, and customs of land and naval warfare. B. Atrocities and offenses, including atrocities and persecutions on racial and religious grounds, committed since 1933. This is only to recognize the principles of criminal law as they are generally observed in civilized states. These principles have been assimilated as a part of the international law at least since 1907. C. Invasions of other countries and initiation of wars of aggression in violation of international law or treaties. For Jackson, the last of these charges was much the most important, as the crime which comprehends all lesser crimes is the crime of making unjustifiable war. Harking back to his 1941 Havana speech, Jackson not only invoked the Kellogg-Briand Pact, but, more compellingly, the history of the English common law, which developed not primarily by acts of Parliament, but by decisions reached from time to time in adapting settled principles to new situations. And now was the critical time for such action. Any legal position asserted on behalf of the United States will have considerable significance in the future evolution of international law. In untroubled times, progress toward an effective rule of law in the international community is slow indeed. Inertia rests more heavily upon the Society of Nations than upon any other society. Now we stand at one of those rare moments when the thought and institutions and habits of the world have been shaken by the impact of the World War on the lives of countless millions. Such occasions rarely come and quickly pass. We are put under a heavy responsibility to see that our behavior during this unsettled period will direct the world's thought toward a firmer enforcement of the laws of international conduct so as to make war less attractive to those who have governments and the destinies of peoples in their power. As reflected in the press, Jackson's report made a profound public impression. The distinguished publicist Walter Lippmann described it as an historic state paper. The St. Louis Post-Dispatch, under the headline Justice Jackson's Magnificent Report, called it an eloquent and many-sided declaration on the job that lies ahead. By no means was criticism lacking, but the dissenting voices were few. Chapter 4. Establishing the Court. The London Charter. I took no part in Jackson's report, as early in June I had gone on leave to visit my parents and in-laws. Upon returning, I learned that Jackson had no need of my prompting on moving to London. Back in Washington, he had at once told his senior staff that they should get ready to go in about 2 weeks. In mid-June, when I first met Jackson in his new capacity, he told me that he and some 15 others would be leaving within a week, and that he wished me to remain in charge of his Washington office until the major local sources of evidence had been combed, after which I should join him in Europe. This fitted my personal desires, as I had been away for 2 years, and wished to stay longer in Washington before again going overseas. On June 18th, Jackson and 16 of his staff flew to London. Those chosen comprised the justice and his three personal assistants, his son, Ensign William Jackson, Major Lawrence Coleman, and Mrs. Elsie Douglas, Alderman, Shea and his secretary Elizabeth Leonard, Bernays, James Donovan, for whom Jackson had secured a double promotion to commander, Gordon Dean, Captain Ralph Morgan, and five other secretarial assistants. They were followed a few days later by General Donovan and Robert Story, a Texas lawyer who, during the war, had been an Air Corps colonel doing both legal and intelligence work. In mid-June, Jackson had personally recruited Story, with whom he was already acquainted. In London, Jackson, General Donovan, Alderman Shea, and James Donovan were accommodated at the prestigious Claridge's Hotel. The others were billeted comfortably but less fashionably. The distinction did not pass unnoticed by Bernays and was a seed of later staff grumbling. With the departure of the Jackson Group, the Washington office became a backwater, and my responsibilities were not onerous. Furthermore, I had able associates, including Ben Kaplan and several new recruits. Among these were two brilliant lawyers who had been serving in the Coast Guard, Lieutenant Commander Harold Leventhal, in later years a member of the United States Circuit Court of the District of Columbia, and Commander Sidney Kaplan, an old friend with whom I had worked on the staff of the Senate Interstate Commerce Commission and later in the Department of Justice. Essentially, my task was to ensure that the possible sources of evidence in Washington were adequately combed. The evidentiary resources of the JAG had already been discounted, but in support of the aggressive war charges, JAG officers were compiling and analyzing the various international treaties and other agreements broken by the Nazi government. Ben Kaplan continued to probe the OSS claims that James Donovan had advanced. They were never borne out, and early in July, Kaplan reported that the OSS studies will be little more than presentations of data generally available, useful chiefly as a basis for further work with richer sources in Europe. At the State Department, where Sidney Kaplan was conducting our search, we had better luck. Quite a number of German secret records of conferences and interagency communications had been uncovered by target teams in Europe and sent back to the department, and for the first time we began to realize that the Teutonic penchant for meticulous record-keeping would greatly ease our task of proving the criminal charges. The fruits of our documentary searching in Washington, which Jackson declared were of great value, arrived in London at about the same time as a much richer haul from the European continent. In Paris, Colonel Ammon had been joined by Robert Story and Colonel Robert Gill, a Baltimore lawyer commissioned in the military police. Story was given charge of collecting and organizing the documentary evidence. Ammon continued in charge of interrogation, and Gill was designated executive officer of Jackson's staff on the continent. The evidentiary situation, which in June had been so dismal, was very encouraging by the end of July, both as to what was in hand and what might be expected in the near future. In Washington, matters had progressed so rapidly that by July 3rd, I was able to inform Jackson that the evidentiary search there could be wound up during the month of July, except for some odds and ends which may tail over into August. And so it worked out. During July, all but a few of the Washington staff were transferred to London, and early in August, I made ready to follow them. Section 2. Vital as the evidentiary search was, Jackson rightly gave first priority to concluding an agreement with the other three powers on the establishment of the International Tribunal for Trials of the Nazi Leaders. The Americans took office space at 49 Mount Street, near Park Lane, and their British counterpart, BWCE, was located at Church House on Great Smith Street, where most of the international conferences were held. The French and Russians were not due to arrive until the last week of June. At this juncture, the BWCE was headed by the newly appointed Attorney General, Sir David Maxwell Fife, and its other members, including G.D. Roberts, King's Counsel, a prominent member of the criminal bar, Treasury Solicitor Sir Thomas Barnes, and a dozen or so other officials representing the Lord Chancellor, the Foreign Office, and other government agencies. It was decided to appoint working committees, and later that day, four were established, of which Committee 2, to draft a protocol, was the most immediately important. Jackson appointed to it Alderman N. Shea, and Fife designated Sir Thomas Barnes, and Patrick Dean representing the Foreign Office. Much more important was a Soviet proposal by N. V. Novikov, minister in Washington, to delete all the provisions for the trial of the Nazi organizations on the ground that they had already been dissolved by the occupying governments. However, it was thought that this request was based on a misunderstanding and that the Soviet delegates could be persuaded to drop it. During most of the period of negotiations on the protocol, the leadership of the British delegation was unstable. The end of the war in Europe triggered pressure in Britain for a general election. In May, Churchill resigned as head of the coalition government, and on June 15th, the King authorized the dissolution of Parliament. During the period from June 15th to July 26th, there was a caretaker government headed by Churchill, and it was in this government that Fife was appointed Attorney General. This meant that his tenure as Attorney General would be ended should the Labour Party win the election, as indeed it did. As the Four-Nation Conference date approached, Jackson had some reason to think that agreement might come easily. In fact, the British and American conceptions of the trial they were planning were not nearly as congruent as the harmony at these meetings might suggest. The British accepted but did not warm to the Americans' wish to establish new principles and procedures in international law, and thought convictions of the Nazi leaders could be more easily and rapidly secured by more conventional means. Sir Thomas Barnes was still insisting that the trial should not last more than 2 weeks. Fife, when he began to grasp the scope of the American plan and the size of Jackson's forces, gasped feebly, "You Americans do things on such a vast scale." But he and most of his colleagues rapidly adjusted themselves to the American vision, and throughout the preparations and the trial, there was good cooperation and harmony between the two delegations. But Britons and Americans alike had overlooked the virtual certainty that a criminal trial involving them with Russian, French, and German lawyers would raise many basic procedural problems quite apart from war crimes. English and American criminal procedures were not identical, but grew from the same English common law roots, and such differences as had developed posed no serious problems. There were also differences among the French, Russian, and German judicial systems, but they all shared concepts and procedures quite different from those of the Anglo-American legal tradition. but there is no evidence that either group had given any prior attention to the problem of how, if at all, the two systems could be married. Section 3. On June 26, 1945, the four delegations to what is officially known as the International Conference on Military Trials met at Church House in London for the first of what proved to be 15 sessions. The French were represented by Judge Robert Falco of the Cour de Cassation. The two Soviet representatives were Major General I.T. Nikichenko, an army judge advocate and vice president of the Soviet Supreme Court, and Professor A.N. Cronin, a distinguished legal academician and author of a well-known book on war crimes. Their interpreter was Oleg A. Troyanovsky, son of a former Soviet ambassador to the United States, a recent graduate of Dartmouth, and a highly intelligent young man who spoke faultless American English. There soon were storm signals. Nikitchenko and Trenin, in line with the Soviet conception of law as the servant of the political leadership, had a very limited idea of the trial's purpose. In the Russians' view, the Nazi organizations had already been condemned as criminal by the Big Three at Yalta, and it was unthinkable that the International Tribunal, an organ of much less authority, could come to any other conclusion. Nikitchenko's attitude was clearly expressed during the second session. "We are dealing here with the chief war criminals who have already been convicted and whose conviction has been already announced by both the Moscow and Crimea declarations by the heads of the governments. The tribunal's task," he later declared, "was only to determine the measure of guilt of each particular person and mete out the necessary punishment, the sentences." Such talk was anathema to Jackson, whose position from the beginning had been that if we are going to have a trial, then it must be an actual trial. He sharply rejected Nikitchenko's statement and for the first, but by no means the last time, suggested that the differences between the American and Soviet positions might be so basic that perhaps the idea of separate trials for each nation for the trial of its separate groups of prisoners may be the easiest and most satisfactory way of reconciling it. Well-founded as Jackson's objection to Nikitchenko's declaration was, his proposal of separate national trials drew no support from the other delegations and later was effectively countered by Nikitchenko, who pointed out that such a procedure would be directly opposed to the Moscow Declaration, which laid down that the trial of the war criminals should be a common task of the United Nations. The situation was temporarily eased, however, by the Soviet delegation's decision, after much discussion, to go along with the American plan for trial of the Nazi organizations. There was also some discussion of the place of trial, and Jackson reported that American Army authorities had suggested that Nuremberg would be an appropriate place from the security point of view. On July 11th, the committee distributed a draft of agreement and charter, which Alderman recommended to Jackson for adoption, subject to further action on a few matters on which no agreement had been reached. The members had approved a Soviet proposal that the court be named International Military Tribunal and that its duties and powers be embodied in a charter. The most important reserved matters were the definitions of the crimes to be charged and the location of the trial or trials. Beneath the surface, however, there was much more unrest than the subcommittee proceedings reflected. Jackson's emphasis on his disagreement with the Russians and his references to abandoning the one-court plan in favor of national tribunals did not pass unremarked by the British. Reporting on July 1st to the Foreign Office, Patrick Dean wrote, "The Treasury Solicitor Barnes and I are both rather worried because the Americans appear to show signs of trying to magnify the differences between their and our views on the one hand and the Russians' views on the other. Justice Jackson, inspired by General Donovan, appears to be thinking that we should now try and reach agreement to set up four courts, each under the presidency of one of the four parties concerned, to handle these trials, and that in this way we should avoid being drawn into a trial which is of too Soviet a character. This course may be eventually necessary, but both Sir Thomas Barnes and I are convinced that nothing has yet appeared in the course of the discussions which renders it necessary, and that the Soviet representatives are, in fact, being very reasonable. In the circumstances, it might be useful if Sir Alexander Cadogan, permanent Undersecretary of the Foreign Office, were willing to see Justice Jackson and emphasize to him the importance which we attach to reach agreement with the Russians on the way in which these trials should be conducted, and to one court only, in the first instance, being set up for this purpose. The Americans have no one from the State Department with them, and General Donovan, who clearly does not like the Russians much, is attracted by the idea of running the courts without Soviet participation. On July 7th, however, Dean informed them that pressure on Jackson was no longer necessary, and Cadogan was not brought into the situation. Whatever Dean thought, Jackson was not undergoing a change of heart about the Russians. On July 7th, he flew to Wiesbaden, where he met Ammann, armed with very useful captured documents, and Alan Dulles, bringing prospective German witnesses. The following day, Jackson and General Donovan met in Frankfurt with General Clay and his political adviser, Robert Murphy, neither of whom was likely to tell Jackson that the Russians were easy to deal with. Clay confirmed to them that Nuremberg was the best place in the American zone of occupation for a big trial, and the Jackson group promptly went there to have a look. Symbolically, the city was quite appropriate for a trial of the Nazi leaders, as it was here that the Nazi Party had staged its annual mass demonstrations and where the anti-Semitic Nuremberg laws had been decreed in 1935. Physically, it was still a shambles, but the outskirts and suburbs were comparatively undamaged, and the courthouse, known as the Palace of Justice, though partially in ruins, was reparable and its structural qualities very suitable. There was extensive office space, a courtroom which could be altered and enlarged for a trial of 20 or so accused, a large adjacent jail with a tunnel connecting it to the courthouse, and good external security. All agreed that it would do, though a lot of work would have to be done quickly to get it ready for a trial in the autumn. After a brief visit to Salzburg in the American zone of Austria, Jackson and General Donovan arrived in Paris on July 10th. Here, the division of functions among Ammann, Story, and Gill was arranged, and the next day Jackson's group returned to London, accompanied by Story, who had had his own troubles with the Russians during the last year of the war. The next day, Alderman's report to the committee was scrutinized by Jackson and his aides, and that evening, Alderman had to interrupt his dinner to confer with Ensign Jackson and Major Coleman, who were very critical of it, provoking Alderman to tell them that such comments should come from Jackson himself. The following day, Friday, July 13th, described in Alderman's diary as Bad Luck Friday, the four delegations resumed their sessions. Shea met Jackson on the way to breakfast and was told that the report had given away a number of our essential plans, primarily in its failure to provide for advance notice to Nazi organization members that their organization would be accused of criminality so that the members would have an opportunity to be heard on the matter. Outside the meeting room at Church House, Jackson, Shea, and Alderman encountered Fife and Barnes, both of whom said they were delighted with the report. Jackson replied that it was a good draft for the Russians. In Shea's words, the justice really knocked the wind out of the British. But when the meeting began, Jackson at first ignored the new draft and instead launched a cross-examination of the other representatives with respect to the scope of their authority. Were they authorized to sign an agreement, or would they have to refer back to their governments? Were they authorized, as he was, to prepare and prosecute the case? The answers disclosed that Fife had authority to sign and to prosecute, which of course he was soon to lose when the Labour Party won the election, but that Falco and Nikitchenko were authorized only to sign, and the identities of the French and Soviet prosecutors were yet to be determined. Jackson treated these revelations as a threat to the prospects for rapid progress toward the trial. He described vividly, and with good reason, the need for prompt notice of the place of trial to the military authorities in Germany so that the necessary reconstruction could get underway, claimed that the president had appointed him on the theory that I would be back the 1st of October when our court resumes sitting, and warned that the official policy of the United States, as set forth in his presidentially approved report, was that whether we got an agreement or not, we would go ahead and try these people that are in our captivity. Jackson's report to the president on June 7, 1945, had stated, "The American case, in being prepared on the assumption that an inescapable responsibility rests upon this country to conduct an inquiry, preferably in association with others, but alone if necessary, into the culpability of those whom there is probable cause to accuse of atrocities and other crimes." Fife soon turned the discussion to the new draft, and some progress was made on minor points.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.